Good morning, Michael.
How are you, Jody?
So let's go ahead and jump right in. And so starting at a high level, Michael, how would you say the pandemic of 2020 has impacted the macro economy?
I think that what we found in 2020 and our response to the pandemic is a lot of business as usual was no longer practical, and eventually we found it was no longer necessary. So we're all, I think, pretty familiar with some big changes, the transition and acceleration to remote work. And with that transformation and acceleration to remote education. And you could say 2020 saw a certain crystallization and conversion to a much more efficient economy. You know, I think you could say it's the end of the commute and the end of business travel as we know it. The nexus of business activity shifted from the office to the home, and the nexus of shopping activity shifted from stores to the handset or the computer. Nexus shifted away from hotels, away from public squares. It became a lot harder for us to congregate. It became a lot harder to do things that required mass and motion. As we found that we have to do things remotely, that accelerated the virtualization of entire segments of our economy.
Can you tell us a little bit about how that's affected the business operations?
I think most businesses realize now they have to have a virtual storefront. If you're going to sell goods or services, it's unlikely you're going to do them manually in close contact. And as we have transitioned from doing things manually and labor-intensive, capital-intensive, real estate-intensive fashion, we've realized our websites are more important, our social media presence is much more important, and the software that we use to either market the product or sell the product or service the product has become much more important. It's a real big shift to the, I mean, we talk about digital transformation. This was a massive acceleration in digital transformation of lots and lots of things.
Yeah, so you've talked a little bit about how it's impacted business operations, products and services. What would you say it's impacted on the financial markets?
The things that we can dematerialize to software travel very, very quickly if we could virtualize it. And so virtual products, virtual services exploded in utility in the last 12 months. Manual products and services were much more challenged and attenuated. And of course, what we discovered is that financialization, anything that can be expressed as a financial product, was able to move virtually. We can move $1 million as easily as $1 billion, as easily as a dollar. And so those kind of businesses scale very rapidly. I think what we saw in 2020, you know, as we, you know, call a K-shaped recovery, we saw that that manual Main Street-based products and services they disseminated very slowly. They're very challenged. They have to be really completely rethought, and people shifted their demand away from them. And then on the other hand, financial products bounced back much more rapidly. You could almost say the political response to the pandemic is such that it's very challenging to do things that require material and manual labor, but governments found it's much easier to distribute virtual products, and the ultimate virtual product is money, and financial products. So the response to the pandemic tended to be a fiscal and a monetary stimulus response, and that resulted in an explosion of interest in those things. As the financial markets recovered, just about everybody started downloading the Square Cash application. They downloaded Robinhood. They started to focus upon financial activity. If you can't go to a sporting event and gamble on the sporting event, you can go to the stock market and you can gamble on the stock market because it's completely virtualized.
Yeah. So you use this term a lot at the company, virtual wave. What exactly is the virtual wave?
You know, the virtual wave is a paradigm shift, a big paradigm shift. The last major paradigm shift was the mobile wave, and that kicked off in 2010. And that was the leaping, the transformation of software from the desktop and the laptop to the mobile device. And the virtual wave is a dramatic acceleration in the dematerialization of processes and products and the way that we interact with people. It used to be that we went to business events and all of a sudden the business events dematerialized to be online events. It used to be we went to business meetings and the business meetings dematerialized to be Zoom meetings. It used to be that we shipped products and then the products dematerialized to software. So the virtual wave is just a dramatic transformation in the way that we live.
Who would you describe to be the big technology winners of the virtual wave?
As we transitioned from communicating to people in person, we started communicating online, and so you saw a dramatic growth in dependence on Twitter, right? I think we've seen an explosion in utilization of YouTube. People are now using YouTube to upload educational content as well as upload entertainment content. And in a world where you can't go to a football stadium and you're on your computer, or you can't go to a movie theater, then you tend to go to the products that make it easiest to stream that video. And so Twitter and YouTube were big winners. We all know the story of Zoom, which went from 10 million users to 400 million users in a matter of weeks. We've seen an explosion in social media. We've seen an explosion in online streaming video. We all know the stories of the entertainment online streaming services. I mean, Netflix is a big winner. Disney Plus has been a big winner. And in the business world, AWS, Azure, cloud service providers have seen an explosion in demand. All of these things are ways to virtualize a message, virtualize a service, virtualize a product.
What would you say that it takes to really compete in the new world?
If I replace 10,000 salespeople with one website, then what I'm doing is I'm automating the sales activity, right? And so there's an explosion in demand for coding skills to automate. The other thing that I've noticed is, you know, it used to be you would have 5,000 bars with 5,000 different bands playing at the same time. Now you have one band playing on YouTube to 500,000 people. So what you have is an explosion of popularity of the celebrities and the best products. So specialization is really important. The world doesn't want the average bluegrass band. The world wants the best bluegrass band on YouTube. And that means the bluegrass band that records in super high definition 4K with great stereo sound, that's attractively produced, that puts out really high quality content every single week, that band might very well generate 1 million followers or 1 million customers. And the good news is the band explodes. And the bad news is 3,700 local bands whose primary value proposition is they're in front of your face playing at the county fair on a Saturday afternoon, they struggle. So specialization is really key. You need to be the best in the world at what you do. Automation is really key. You need to find a way to deliver it via a website. Acceleration is really key. People expect lots of high quality content and really good services and features to be delivered faster. All of these things play into the notion of virtualization. And what do we really want in this world? Well, we want people that have insanely great coding skills, or we want people that have really good communication skills. If you can communicate, tell me why I want to buy that product. We can upload that to YouTube. You might have 350,000 views of that one salesperson explaining why you should buy that product. In the 20th century, we would have hired 10,000 salespeople to meet with every doctor and every hospital and explain as best they can why you should prescribe that drug. Today, why wouldn't you just have the single best communicator articulate that, upload it to YouTube, and let every doctor in the world download the video 1.2 million times. So being a really good communicator is important, and without coding skills, you have no product.
So you talked a little bit about some of the winners of the virtual wave, what it takes to compete, some of the skills that you need in this new world. What is the biggest surprise that you've seen in the virtual wave?
You know, I think we saw YouTube coming, and I think we saw Twitter, and we knew about social media, Facebook and Twitter and LinkedIn and Snapchat. These things, they were all coming. We even knew about AWS and Azure. They were all gradually coming, and even Zoom was creeping. I think the biggest surprise, which was a shocker to me, is the emergence of a monetary network. The virtualization of products and services and things that people did, well, that most people can get their hands around that. They experience that. But the virtualization of money, that's a big idea. We have $300 trillion worth of money floating around in stocks, bonds, commercial real estate, and cash in banks. And it's the 20th century form of assets. And what we saw this year is an explosion, an emergence of a new form of money. And that new form of money is cryptocurrency. And the winning cryptocurrency is Bitcoin. And as we discovered digital scarcity in the form of money, we realized that it's an open network, an open system form of virtual currency. And of course, what's interesting about it is you can plug it into a mobile application. So Bitcoin got plugged into Square Cash and PayPal, and the next stop is hundreds of millions of people plugging their mobile apps into a digital monetary network. And as Bitcoin got plugged into, it's getting plugged into mutual funds and investment funds, and we plugged into our company, we're really seeing the emergence of a dominant digital monetary network. Twitter became a dominant digital speech network. Facebook is a dominant digital social network. Amazon is a dominant digital retail network. Apple is a dominant digital mobile network of its own. And yet we never really thought there would be a digital monetary network. We didn't really need it before March, but in March of 2020, with the K-shaped recovery, simultaneously what we realized is Main Street needs to virtualize, and we needed to virtualize our products and our services in order to deliver them with much, much lower friction and human contact and at the speed of light. And then we also realized that we needed to find a way to virtualize our money, because the financial response to the pandemic is one of monetary expansion. And the monetary expansion has created asset inflation. And the asset inflation has created a stampede toward a new monetary system, a better monetary system, just like Twitter is a better way to communicate your speech, just like YouTube is a better way to move your entertainment or your education content around. Bitcoin is a better way to move your money around. And that's one I just didn't see coming at all.
Yeah. So you talked a little bit at the macro level, but when you come back to sort of the company, we've termed this virtual wave. We use it a lot here at MicroStrategy. What would you say, how have we adjusted to the virtual wave?
Well, first thing we realized is the website is supreme. People need to be able to do everything on your website. So we overhauled our website and we made it possible to go and get all the marketing information you need about the company. We overhauled all of our sales information. We really converted our website into a YouTube type experience because we realized that it's got to be video first. So any question you have about the product, you could find out via video on our website. We turned our website into our best salesperson in essence, because anybody can show up 24/7, 365. They can register. They can find out everything about our products. They can also start a trial. So we made it possible for people to start to do demos and to engage with us. We made it possible for people to get tech support on the website directly. We virtualized our education and made it possible for all of our customers to learn anything on our website. We virtualized our investor relations. Now you can go and find that out. We virtualized our recruiting activity. If you want to know what roles are available, they're on the website. So the website really became front and center, and it replaced hundreds of thousands of hours of activity with automated video and automated routines. And that was a big first step. I think the next thing we realized is we're going to have to embrace social media much more enthusiastically. We can't spread the message and communicate to customers by getting on planes and flying to places and staying in hotels and knocking on doors and showing up in offices. It's just not practical anymore. And so we adopted Twitter, and I began to tweet a lot more. We adopted YouTube. We adopted podcasting. You know, we discovered microphones, and we discovered higher quality cameras, and we realized that it's not practical to speak to customers one at a time. You need to speak to customers 100,000 times in a row. So we started to create content and upload it into the major networks, into Twitter, into YouTube, into LinkedIn, and just make it easier for people to communicate to us. And those external things, I think you can see those if you're a customer. There was also an internal set of changes. We really moved toward acceleration and compression of our internal meetings and our business reviews. We would have 20 people in a time, and we'd spend a week working on it. And then we realized that, well, we could just, we could upload the presentation as a video and attach it to the review and then ask the 20 people to watch the video before they showed up to the meeting. And when you watch a video before the meeting, then you can speed it up and watch it 50% faster. If I watch it 50% faster, instead of 20 hours taken up for a 1 hour meeting, maybe it's 10 hours that are taken up for the 1 hour meeting. Well, then what happened next is we realized that half the people just wanted the content. They didn't really need to be at the meeting. So we were able to save their time and only 10 people show up to the meeting. And then we realized that, well, if everybody shows up to the meeting and they already know everything is going to be presented in the first 1 minute, we can just start to talk about how we feel about it. So our meetings became much more interactive. And of course, we also realized that 10 people could show up. We could have a 15-minute meeting. Everybody could express their opinion and we could resolve the meeting in 15 minutes. So our 1 hour meeting became a 15-minute meeting, and our 1 week process became a 1 day process. And as that evolved, we realized that we didn't even necessarily need to think in terms of meetings. we could integrate video directly into our systems of record. So if we have 100 features to build in the product, we might create a 2-minute video for each feature, put it into our program management system. And then when I come in the morning, I see 22 features. I click on the feature, I look at the video, I approve the feature, or I give feedback, and there never was a meeting. We actually moved to an organic flow where somebody in China who's asleep when I'm awake is able to upload a video, and I watch it while they're asleep, and I give them my comments. And then the next morning when they come in, they actually know what I think, even though we're in different parts of the world and different time zones. And herein is really the magic of the virtual wave, which is we realize you can bend time and space. You know, it's possible for people all around the world to be working in different locations at different times and yet be together. And once we realized that, we started implementing a 24/7 culture of response, where a customer might call in with a tech support case. We could record the tech support case, upload it in our system of record, and direct it to an engineer that isn't even awake. And then when they get up and they come in the office somewhere else in the world, they can see what the customer thought. They can fix the bug. They can upload in the system of record. And then someone 3,000 miles away comes in to work 8 hours later. They see it. They pass it on. And we can follow the sun from the United States to China to Europe. And perhaps 24 hours later, we will have people in 3 different time zones work on the problem, solve the problem, and deliver it back to the customer. And everybody feels a certain intimacy and understanding of what the customer wanted to do. It's an incredibly empowering, you know, as we moved into this virtual wave. And the big result is we realized that people in different places in the world could all work together in different time zones. And we were released from the tyranny of fixed meetings. You don't have to fly from Europe to the United States for a week to sit in a bunch of grueling meetings in order to be engaged with other people. You could be intellectually engaged much more intimately in a much more agile fashion. And you could do it from the comfort of your own home. And it's much more physically healthy. It's much more emotionally, intellectually satisfying. I have traveled around the world, Jody, and I remember, you know, flying around the world to give 20 speeches in 20 different time zones, and it's just so it's so grueling, right? It's so hard on your body to be upside down in time zones. The idea that you could communicate to everybody that works with you or everyone that relies upon you, and you could do it from the comfort of your own time zone in a comfortable environment, that's a really powerful thing. You know, people talk about, if we think about remote work, the challenge of how you stay intimately engaged with your coworkers. On one hand, you could say, if you're fixed in the 20th century view, it's like, I need them to be in the office face to face or I can't communicate to them. That's one way of thinking. And by the way, that's the way I thought a year ago, right? That's the way I thought you had to be in front of me for me to communicate. And then we went through this jarring transition to the virtual wave. And then we learned how to virtually communicate. And I remember, wasn't that long ago, I spoke with everybody that works for our company in Argentina, and they are 12 hours away from us. And yet I was able to speak with each one of them intimately, engaged, and it wasn't expensive, and it wasn't a challenge or a physical demand on their time, and it wasn't challenging for me. And so I was able to engage with them better, faster, stronger, smarter, cheaper. No real downside. And after I did that, the next week, I met with all of our partners in South America. And so I found that we're much better able to communicate once we embrace these new techniques. And the result is a lot of expensive, painful activity drops away. and a lot of constructive, cheerful activity explodes. And for the organization that can embrace that kind of virtual wave, you can find this incredibly empowering.
Yeah, I agree. I, you know, personally for me, I've seen our employees adapt so quickly overnight into this, you know, change and videos and being online. And so it's just been amazing for me to see that as well from our own employees. And so can you tell us a little bit about how it's changed the company's product strategy?
Just like we want to be able to accomplish something from a distance. In the era of the virtual wave, you need to be able to accomplish things from a distance virtually. 10 people in 10 different places need to be able to act in a coordinated fashion effectively with each other, with their vendor. And that means it's just not practical to have manual steps and complex steps in the process. So what we did was really thought about how do you deliver business intelligence to an enterprise in the era of the virtual wave, in the era of remote work. And it becomes pretty clear there are certain things that are critical. One of them is you need to be able to deliver that intelligence out of the cloud. And cloud becomes more important than ever. Because when people decide to upgrade, and they're going to upgrade, they don't really have 6 weeks or 4 weeks. You can't have three people coming on site in order to install new software. And it can't be that challenging. So the parts of our business that we have really attacked and worked to re-engineer away are upgrade friction and migration friction. We put a big emphasis on cloud migration, a big emphasis on upgrading all of our customers to the latest version of our software, a big emphasis on deploying our software in a multi-tenant SaaS model. And so we just launched Hyper Now. And Hyper Now is all about deploying hyper intelligence to anybody in the world in less than an hour. If somebody is in Singapore or they're in Sydney, Australia, and it's midnight our time and noon their time on the weekend, and they decide that they want to deploy hyper intelligence, how are they going to do it? Their journey is going to be hit the website, register, start their cloud, their Hyper Now trial. They need to be able to plug in their database, their security model. They need to be able to build the application. They need to be able to deploy it, and they need to be able to embed it in their website. And so our emphasis on embedding intelligence into applications and into websites has been enhanced. And of course, along the way, we made this rule, which is, if you have to ask for help, we've failed. And so we have been relentlessly polishing our Hyper Now offering and our modern business intelligence platform so that anybody in the world anytime can build compelling business intelligence embedded in their operation and not ask for help from a human being. It has to all be self-evident, or if there's anything sophisticated, it needs to be easy to get that insight online, on demand, anytime. So you could say it's just all about streamlining for us.
So you talked a little bit about our operational changes, our product strategy changes. What about our corporate strategy? What would you say has changed from our corporate strategy?
The big picture is the company sells business intelligence software. We streamline the operations of the software so as to deliver that in a more automated, more virtualized fashion. Software. That has resulted in a dramatic increase in cash flow of the company. The company generates a lot more cash than ever before. The second thing we've done is we've streamlined the product itself so that we can actually grow the business without using a lot of manual labor and without throwing a lot of cash at the business. And as we have gone through that transformation in our P&L, we realized that we have a lot of cash on our balance sheet and our treasury, and we have to figure out how to create shareholder value with it. So one of the biggest impacts on our corporate strategy is that as we realized that we had a great cash generating business And we weren't going to need to utilize that cash to grow the business and scale it. We started thinking about how we best utilize the money. And the year 2020 is an environment of quite aggressive monetary expansion. So as the money supply of dollars and euros has expanded, that has caused an appreciation in asset prices against those dollars. And if we want to preserve shareholder value, we realize that we need to make sure that the cash flows we generate and the cash that we maintain in our treasury is invested in some kind of asset, which is going to appreciate as fast as all the other assets in the market. So that caused us to embrace a Bitcoin strategy. And the idea behind Bitcoin is Bitcoin is an engineered safe haven treasury reserve asset. And because it's engineered to be fixed in supply on a global network, that means that if we invest $1 million in Bitcoin, and if the supply of dollars doubles, the price of Bitcoin should reasonably double or go up faster. It becomes an asset inflation hedge. So our big move from a corporate point of view this year is to transition our balance sheet from U.S. dollars and treasury bills, treasury notes, and sovereign debt as our primary treasury reserve asset to Bitcoin as our primary treasury reserve asset. And that has worked out well for us. Another part of our corporate strategy is we realized that one of the advantages we have as a publicly traded company is we have access to cheap financing in the capital markets. So we've engaged in financing, and we've gone and we have raised $650 million in debt. And we did it because we could actually raise the money at less than 1% interest at 75 basis points. So for all practical purposes, it becomes free money. So we dramatically strengthened our balance sheet by tapping into those capital markets. And we have invested that in Bitcoin. And as we have done those things, and Bitcoin has appreciated, our balance sheet has appreciated. And we think that that gives us a really strong treasury reserve, and it gives us a strong asset we can use to continue in our mission of building and selling the world's best business intelligence software.
So if you want to hear more about the Bitcoin strategy, you can join our Bitcoin track here at World. So it should be exciting to hear some of that. So how can some of our customers take advantage of the virtual wave? What are some of the trends you're seeing there?
Across our customer base, I see there's a migration from on-premise to the cloud. So we've worked to deploy tools and better upgrade programs. And lots of our customers, 1,000 of our customers or more have engaged with us via our enterprise support program to either upgrade their platform to the latest version of MicroStrategy or to migrate their platform to our cloud environment so that they can continue to stay on the latest version of MicroStrategy, and also to decrease the cost and the complexity of deploying business intelligence throughout their enterprise. So cloud upgrades and migrations, really big trend. Another big trend is taking advantage of our modern platform to embed intelligence into their applications and in their websites, because all of their customers want one-click intelligence or seamless intelligence right in front of their face. And so taking friction out of the business and taking friction out of the process of getting the answer has been really critical. Embedded intelligence has exploded in popularity in the past year. And then I think a very specific form of embedded intelligence is hyperintelligence. The idea of putting hyperintelligence right into your applications and into your websites means that if your customers are on your website or your employees are on your website trying to figure out whether to buy the product or ship it or what to do with you, if they can hover over that thing and get the answer with zero click, then that's a big benefit to them. So hyperintelligence has exploded. And I think the best idea for customers is try embedding hyperintelligence in your applications using HyperNow, because anybody could go onto our website, spin up a HyperNow environment. They could plug in their data. They could plug in their security model. They could embed hyperintelligence into their website using our SDK, or they could deploy hyperintelligence across anybody else's websites using our plugin, and they could do that in an hour. You know, so what other technique is there to deploy better intelligence to hundreds of thousands or millions of people today out of the cloud? And everybody's got some intelligence that will help their customer or their employee make a better decision. So HyperNow represents a real step change, order of magnitude difference in the cost and the complexity of providing intelligence to the world. So I'm really excited to see how our customers take advantage of our new multi-tenant cloud, our SaaS offering, and HyperNow, and what's to come.
It's been interesting. Using Hyper and HR has been awesome, even for my team. I think nowadays we can't even not have it turned on when we're working. It's been great. As we wrap up, what would you say are the most compelling opportunities in the coming 1 to 3 years?
For most corporations, the compelling opportunities are either going to be to completely virtualize some aspect of their sales or marketing process, or completely virtualize their product to be provisioned via their website and potentially virally plugging it into the social networks. And I think every company's got to be thinking about how you virtualize that aspect of their P&L, their product and their service. Another really compelling opportunity is plugging your company's products or services or balance sheet into this emerging digital monetary network, which we call Bitcoin. If you have a mobile application like Square or PayPal, they're plugging those mobile applications into Bitcoin. And what that means is anybody with a Square application can go ahead and move $1,000 into Bitcoin. And Bitcoin has been appreciating at 200% per year against the US dollar for 10 years, tax-free. So when you plug a mobile payment application into this monetary network, you're delivering a savings account that yields 200% tax-free interest. That's very differentiating for Square and PayPal. It's been great for their products. Millions and millions of new customers are coming to their network. Their stocks are exploding. They're getting massive publicity on CNBC and cable networks. So it's great for their marketing, great for their branding. We're seeing finance companies like Grayscale, they plug Bitcoin into their financial fund offering, a closed-end fund. And that fund went from $2 billion in assets to $20 billion in assets in 1 year. So they grew by a factor of 10. It's extraordinary. If you look at other companies, all banks can benefit from plugging into this Bitcoin network. There are tens of billions, if not hundreds of billions of dollars that are going to flow from banks that don't support Bitcoin and the monetary network to those that do. Any insurance companies can plug into this network, and there are insurance products that are starting to plug into the Bitcoin monetary standard. Every company has a treasury. Our company has a treasury. And if your company has money on its balance sheet and it's sitting in fiat currencies like euros and dollars, they're losing about 15% of their purchasing power each year. So corporations that have billions of dollars or tens or hundreds of billions of dollars of cash are looking at losing 75% of the shareholder value, 75% of the cash over the course of a decade in the current monetary environment. The simple solution is convert some of that cash into Bitcoin. We did it. Square did it. You're going to see an avalanche of companies in the coming 12 months also converting their balance sheets into Bitcoin because it's a scarce digital safe haven asset. So compelling opportunities. I think that you're going, you already know what happened with Google. Google became a $1 trillion company. It was a good idea to plug your website into the Google search engine and plug your marketing into Google's YouTube. And we know what happened with Apple. People embraced the mobile wave, Apple and Android. We know what happened with Facebook. People embraced Facebook. We know what happened with Twitter. We know what happened with AWS and Azure and the cloud. Most people don't realize what's going to happen here with the digital monetary network, but we're looking at a monetary network that's going to grow from $650 billion in value to $6 trillion to $60 trillion. It may very well become north of $100 trillion in monetary value. And every company has a treasury which would benefit from plugging into it. And every financial company would probably benefit from plugging its financial products or services into this network, because this decade is going to be a decade of explosion in this digital monetary network and this thing we call Bitcoin. It really is quite an extraordinary opportunity, in my opinion, probably the most compelling opportunity I've seen in my lifetime.
I think I've learned more about Bitcoin in the last 3 months than I ever have, and it's been really fascinating. So, well, that wraps up our session today. Thank you, Michael. And thanks to everybody for joining us, and I hope you enjoy the rest of the conference.
Sorry, I was busy taking screenshots of charts to share with you. That's what I do, and I have fun doing it, and I know that we all enjoy it. So anyway, Bitcoin, $37,000 here. This price action is not at all related to what's going on the conference. The conference is an absolute enormous signal. As you're seeing Michael Saylor present the playbook to other corporations, when you've put $1.3 billion of Bitcoin on your balance sheet, and they've seen your stock skyrocket, you've made waves. Now they're handing off the playbook. They're giving it to everyone else so everyone else could get on board. It's a big deal. How long is that going to take? It takes about 6 weeks or so, give or take, several weeks. Some will do it sooner. Some will do it longer. Price will be rising. $70,000 is the next thing we're looking at here on Bitcoin, right? What does that mean? Some of those corporations will have gotten in here. Some of those corporations will have gotten in here. By the way, we have about 15 more minutes until we go live here. I'm going to have to go back to look at some charts right now, because in about 15 minutes at the top of the hour is when we're going to see Michael Saylor present the keynote live. Go check the mic. Hold on 1 second. We got a mic check, 1, 2, 1, 2, mic check. How are we sounding over there? I am. This Josh is all over it. Josh is all over it. I am so invested. What do we got? We got, you know, beautiful wife, 5 kids, another on the way, private school, healthcare, right? Vacations. How did you know? Yeah, I have over 50% of my net worth. That was back in. I started bringing this to your attention when Bitcoin was trading around $7,000 back on this channel. That's when we got everyone positioned into it. Of course, I'm well invested. It's the most important trade there is. There we go. Great. I'm going to pull up now. I'm going to go over to my normal setup over here so I can look at some charts. I'll go back to this in a little bit. I'm going to come over to, let's see. There we go. Boom, boom. How do you like it now? Here we go. Back to our normal setup. We'll go back live as MicroStrategy goes live. Once that keynote starts at the top of the hour, about 15 minutes. And guess what? Since I'm here, I'm going to take a look what's going on. I like to see Bitcoin 37,000. I have to say that feels a lot better than Bitcoin 32,000. Bitcoin 32,000 just a couple of days ago felt good as well, right? What about when Bitcoin was trading at 29,000? Did you have the awareness, the mindset to be adding? People are looking right now. When's a good time to add to Bitcoin? As Bitcoin was dipping down 30,000 on this channel, on Twitter, I told you this is your opportunity to buy the dip. Everyone wanted to buy Bitcoin below 20,000. Below 20,000 is when I said I'm fully in it more. Look at 40,000, right? If you didn't get it and you saw Bitcoin at 40,000 and then it came back to 30,000, I said, this is the dip. This is your time to buy Bitcoin under 30,000. A lot of people felt that was highly irresponsible. Whatever. You don't understand Bitcoin. You don't understand the work that I've been presenting here for over a year. That's fine. I don't really care. Have fun staying poor, right? That's what it is, and that's what it is. But here we are right now, and people are like, oh, now is a good time to buy Bitcoin. Where have you been? Watch us every day. Find out the flow. Get in the flow. Educate yourself. Get behind it. And then when I'm talking about Bitcoin, you can be stoked about it because you understand it and you're involved in the most important trade that matters. As Michael Saylor, the Chad, has just pointed out, you know, he thinks it's the opportunity of a lifetime. Where are you? Here I am. All right, what's going on? Ethereum over here, also pumping over here. New all-time highs into price discovery right now. Ethereum's never traded higher than this. Everyone holding Ethereum right now is in profit. Beautiful to see, beautiful watch. We expect Ethereum to outperform Bitcoin at this point in the cycle. That doesn't make a difference for me, for many of you. The trade is Bitcoin, the only trade that matters. Why are we doing two streams in one day? I mean, listen, I'm very consistent in that every morning, Monday through Friday, I live stream with all of you. Pretty consistent Monday through Thursday, uploading video updates in the afternoon. That's what I do to keep myself sharp. Today is the Bitcoin conference, the MicroStrategy Bitcoin conference. It's a huge deal. It's a huge deal. I'm here live for it. I'm watching it. I prefer to watch it with my friends. You guys are my family. You guys are my friends. You're my community. Look, I'm watching it. I want to share that with you. Of course, you know, there's always the one or two that drop in there. The popping sound is annoying. Whatever. I don't really care. But here we are. Those that know, right? My heart is big. I want to bring everyone with me. Some will come. Others will not. Many will be left behind. Only the strong will survive. That's capitalism. That is capitalism. And that's where I make my living, in the capital markets. So here we are. What else is going on, right? What else is going on? Right back at you. Genuinely from the heart. Genuinely from the heart. Genuinely from the heart. If you missed this morning's live stream or you're just joining us for the first time, for whatever reason, the algorithm has brought you to this special place. Do subscribe to the channel. Watch this morning's live stream. Get a feel for understanding what we do. But if you're looking for someone to tell you when to buy something, right? Right now, anyway, I have no idea. But I assume that like the people are looking like, where can I get my quick fix? What's the next GameStop? What's the next GameStop? You know, is it AMC? Should I put my paycheck into AMC? You're going to get wrecked. You're going to lose money. You're going to lose money. That's right. Heath has been here for day one. Heath, Trade Talk, by the way. That says Heath, not Trade Talk. That's awesome. Heath of Trade, Heath, formerly known as Trade Talk. Heath is putting out amazing content. If you want to find his YouTube channel, go ahead into my YouTube channel. Look at the featured channels, usually Heath's channel, as well as you see Brandon, Crypto Trades and Tech. They are CTM to the core, sharing lots of information, great information. Make sure that you're following their content. Absolutely. Happy to be here with you all right now. We have about another 10 minutes or so until the conference is about to start. It should be, I'm expecting it's Michael Saylor live presenting the keynote and looking forward. We're back to Trade Talk. We got Heath and Trade Talk now. Now I get it. But to find Trade Talk, go to the featured channels on this YouTube. Right, go to feature channels on my YouTube page, and you could find the link to Trade Talk. Right. So what else is going on since April, Lemmy? Lemmy's a huge part of this group. Thank you, Lemmy. Thank you for everything you do. Thank you for your presence. Thank you for everything that you offer, and each and every one of you. How do you single someone out? Do I say Tom? Tom, right? Thank you. How do you do it? Giles, everybody, thank you for being and making CTM what it is. Open the tequila. I'm a mezcal guy. I prefer getting mezcaled if I'm going to, partake. Usually weddings, Mexican weddings, by the way, are phenomenal. You know, Mexican weddings are a lot of fun. That would be, you know, an occasion I might go for the tequila, but not for this event. Since April, Beautiful. Beautiful. And how, since Q2 2020, Josh, for how long have I been saying it'll be in first quarter 2021 that Bitcoin really starts and begins to break all correlations? What has happened since January over here? January, and trying to find January, do we go from 30,000 to 40,000, a 25% increase? We've gone since the middle of December. Hey, pretty good guesstimate there, first quarter 2021. We went up 100% in 25 days on Bitcoin. We have since consolidated down over here. This beautiful consolidation, by the way. Super, going straight vertical is not healthy. It'll lead to a bigger pullback. To see this pullback right now, and now us trying to break out of here, once we do, and once Bitcoin goes into price discovery, that's it, and it's beautiful, and I'm glad to be so dialed into it with all of you. You might feel like, oh, this is kind of easy. I see it. Everyone must see it. It's not even close to the case. And those that see it are putting out massive disinformation against you, trying to get your Bitcoin. If someone is calling $40,000 top for Bitcoin, right? What's the name of the fund? I don't even care. They're irrelevant when you call out information like that. But what are they doing? They're looking to build up about another $500 million position, right? Guggenheim, whatever it is. Yeah, so I'm a Bitcoin guy. Is he speaking currently? Nah, not back on yet. You know, hold on. Nope, the next set, it begins at the top of the hour. We got about nine more minutes. As it happens, I will get back to it. It's where I want to be. It's why we're on here together. What else do we got going on over here? Just trying to top of the end cube, Tom. Thank you for being all over that. Is it a good time to acquire Ethereum? Is it a good time to acquire DOT? Is it a good time to acquire Chainlink? Is it a good time to acquire Aave? Should I be? What do you think of Litecoin? What about Cardano? Right? Brandon, Crypto Trades and Tech, put a dollar price target on Cardano a while ago. All alts right now are just getting warmed up. Alt season has begun. It was about 3 weeks ago on this channel where I was officially like, alt season has begun. I'd been talking and leading up into that when it was going to occur for a while now. It was over a year ago. I said it's about 6 months after the halving that you'll see alt season beginning. I almost got that to the day. I study the cycles. I study the past behavior. It doesn't mean that the future performance is going to equal that of the past. But with Bitcoin, which is coded monetary supply, it certainly does rhyme. And that's why we're riding these waves. We're over here right now, by the way, day 267 after the halving. We're getting close to where we start rising up over here in the past first cycle and second cycle. These next 60 days or so have been, with the exception of this blip here, have been pretty vertical, pretty vertical. It looks like we're going to have a big vertical move. We should then see another big consolidation. That's coming in over here, right? Over here, you can see, sorry, that's an average of the two. On the last cycle over here, this was another 30% drawdown, right? This, by the way, where was the 39% drawdown? Was this the 39% drawdown? I have to go back and look. I don't want to do that right now, but I'm going to. Just so I make sure I have that awareness I need to have. It's very important for me to be dialed in. Let me thank you, brother. Not only for that, thank you for you. You really had a lot. I'm grateful. Here we go. Here's that 39% drawdown. Bitcoin went off to make a new all-time high, swing high. Had a 30% pullback. Made another all-time high just barely. And then had a long, it looks like a 60-day 39% drawdown. That could have been what was exactly happening right now. And until we make new all-time highs, could still be happening, right? But it doesn't look like, as we're breaking out now of that trend line over there, it doesn't look like that's going to happen. But it is quite possible we could visit down somewhere around 26,000. That would be about a 38% pullback, right? This, we've been about 30 days now since this pullback has started. Generally, they last between 30 and as long as 60 days during the bull market phase. Right? Things are looking good. Never get comfortable. Always be looking at your downside. Be very risk adverse. Right? And always, if you're watching your downside, if price all of a sudden starts falling and down there, you're going to be a lot more comfortable. You're going to be a lot more calm. Right? You'll notice as price starts rising and going, I don't really say much. Right? I don't say much when I need to talk about it, when I need to walk you through it mentally, psychologically. That's what I'm there for. So what else? So we got about another 5 more minutes. Getting excited for that. Getting excited that Lemmy, again, thank you for your generosity, but thank you for you. Yeah. Litecoin usually follows Bitcoin. We got 5 more minutes, 4 more minutes. We'll get back live. And what a pleasure watching Bitcoin up almost 5% today, $37,000 as we sit here to enjoy the chat himself, Michael Saylor, present the case for Bitcoin to public corporation America, opening up the port. Kathy Woods, is that her name? ARK Investments, Kathy Woods. If not, I apologize, but I'm more interested in her mind than her name. And she said that, you know, listen, if the S&P, the top 500 companies put in 1% of their balance sheet, that would easily have enough demand to take Bitcoin to 70,000. 70,000 is a number I put out there, by the way, as soon as we had a 30% pullback. I just did 150% off of 29,000, put you around $70,000. We have, more importantly, we have Will's log chart trend line work over there. We also have Adams, we have Mines, we have Patrick's as well. We'll be consulting the resistance as we get there. We're not there yet, right? Between making the new all-time high here and 70,000, we're pretty quiet riding that wave. Once we get up there, we'll be looking. Maybe we'll have another 30% drawdown. I'm not trying to call when we'll have 30% drawdowns. I'm not really interested in it. As they're happening, though, I'm ready for them. All right. Definitely. My pleasure. So we got about 3 more minutes. We'll be ready to go live. We got a second live stream today. That's all good. The more time I get to spend with you, the bigger the smile on my face. Sorry, do we have a link? Yeah, listen, I would love, you know, there's a link if you go to this morning's live stream or maybe an uploaded, or you go to conquertrades.com. You could find out how to sign up for CTM. But in this presentation today, I'm going to focus over on MicroStrategy. I'm going to focus over on what's going on at the conference, on the keynote. Get everyone psyched here as they should be. I've said it before, since in the bear market leading into the halving, I did all the hard work. When it came time to enjoy this beautiful wave and ride, I'm going to do it. This is a moment. This is a morning. As Bitcoin is trading up here, that's always nice. And Michael Saylor is presenting the case of Bitcoin to some of the largest corporations in America, maybe even Tesla, right? Are we going to find out sometime soon that Tesla has actually purchased and placed a bunch of Bitcoin on their balance sheet? Do you think Elon's going to go 5% like Jack Dorsey and Square did? Or do you think Elon's more of an all-in type guy? Don't forget, Elon took all the money he made on PayPal. He took all of the money he made on PayPal and he parlayed that into Tesla. That, come on, man. I mean, do you think Elon goes all in, or do you think Elon goes in when he understands and believes something? You know? And in retrospect, it was inevitable. Elon then changed his bio on Twitter to one word and one word only, Bitcoin. It wasn't SpaceX. It wasn't Tesla. It was Bitcoin. So there we go. We got about 2 more minutes. Wow, that's interesting. I don't know whether or not. I mean, Elon's a showman, right? Do you think on MicroStrategy's day that he announces today? Maybe Tesla announces today. Maybe they don't. I don't know. But it's coming. It definitely looks like it's coming. And the first time that we made note of that was as soon as Michael Saylor reached out to Elon on Twitter and said, hey, listen, you should convert Tesla's balance sheet to Bitcoin. And Elon was like, what? You could do that? He's like, yep, I'll show you how privately. Then Elon flew all the way to Hawaii to meet Larry Ellison, CEO of Oracle, whispers that Oracle was going to do it themselves. And then, here we are. He's on a board member of Tesla, by the way, as well. Follow the money. See what's going on. I'm going to switch over now as we're getting ready for the event to start. I want to make sure that I have that up. Let me move over. Boom, boom. There we go.
afternoon or good evening to everyone. My name is Bill Reedway. I'm the Vice President of Solutions Management for MicroStrategy. I'm so glad that you've joined us today for the Hyperintelligence Channel. We have an action-packed agenda for you today. We want to get right into it, but before we get started, I just want to encourage you to please make good use of the chat function and the reactions function in Social 27 to provide your feedback and questions to us throughout the day. We're going to get started with a video now, and then we will be back with an outstanding panel of MicroStrategy experts to answer some Q&A for you all. And let's go ahead and get started.
All right, wait, hold on one second. My daughter just bought me a beautiful card that she made for me. That's obviously the most important. Listen, I don't know what's going on up here. I'm going to check the rooms. I don't think this is the keynote, right? And we'll see what's going on. MicroStrategy had problems earlier. Are they having problems now? Again, I don't know. I have in my agenda the keynote for Michael, right? That session coming soon. Nope. The session expired at 12 p.m. Eastern. That was the keynote then. By Michael, the recorded version. I want to see what else is going on. All right, let's see what else we've got going on right now or what's live.
Finance at the University of Chicago, writing his dissertation under the direction of Nobel Prize winner Gene Fama. Ross did his undergraduate studies at Wharton, and Ross is the chairman of the Stevens Center for Innovation and Finance at Wharton, which he founded. More importantly, Ross is a friend of mine. He's been an important partner and a trusted guide to me and to various members of MicroStrategy's leadership team as we navigate our own Bitcoin journey. So please help me welcome Ross. And Ross, thanks for joining us today. I'm really excited about this conversation.
I am too, Michael. Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here. And like each of the many conversations you and I have, I'm sure I will enjoy and look forward to this one.
Okay, so let's get right into it. In a sense,
let's do it.
This whole conference is about reserve assets. It's not about property, plant, and equipment or other parts of a firm's business strategy or balance sheet. It's about reserve assets. You and I are both CEOs. We have a lot we need to focus on. We have a lot we need to decide every single day. Why should we even care about reserve assets?
Well, I think a CEO has but also capital allocator. The first one is obvious. The second is more important. Capital allocation is a CEO's most important job. I think all of us CEOs work in capital allocation. In fact, we specialize in it. Whether we're good at it or not, we specialize in it. And said differently, whether or not we choose it, capital allocation chooses us. And I would say a capital allocation framework for a CEO used to be one thing, which is how do we turn our liquid assets into illiquid assets? And how do we turn our illiquid assets back into liquid assets? You know, are we going to buy something? Or are we going to sell something? Are we going to fund a business? Or are we going to close a business? What's changed, though, is that it's now also about our liquid assets as their own thing, your cash reserves. Because what used to be safe and not volatile, it's no longer safe and it's highly volatile.
Well, why is this framework so relevant now?
I mean, it's always been relevant. I mean, what's relevant is the urgency. What's new is the urgency. What's new, I think, is the outsized role of central banks in all of our lives and the role of central banks on corporate balance sheets. I mean, cash is now a liability, no longer an asset. And I think that has profound long-term implications for corporations. I mean, we can go back and start a lot of different places, but we can go back. I mean, one of my favorite Federal Reserve sort of central bank persons is Hayami, Governor Hayami from Japan. He's not a name you hear a lot about now, But he led the BOJ in the year 2000. And he joined right out of college, post-war, 1947. It's hard to imagine Japan back then, but they were in a hyperinflation. Imagine Japan in a hyperinflation. And those hyperinflationary years when he was out of college left an indelible scar on Hayami, understandably. And as he was rising through the ranks of the BOJ, he was known for repeating the phrase, if you debase the currency, you debase the country, in his internal meeting. So that was Hayami. He was a strident anti-inflationist. Now, if we think about Japan back in 2000, right, it's 10 years after the bubble burst. Their benchmark rate, basically their Fed funds, had gone from 8% to zero. And given Hayami's personal background, his anti-inflationary stance, he thought free money was nuts, right? So he decided to do something about it now that he was finally in charge. He took the radical step of raising rates 25 basis points. I mean, pretty radical. Ouch. So he made money slightly non-free, okay? But he didn't just do it. It's really what he said. He kind of had this speech and he thundered, risk must be priced. Risk must be priced, which is really academic jargon for saying the market must determine the price of money, not bureaucrats. So what happens, right? Very predictably. First of all, the prime minister goes ballistic.
Yep.
He says, this is just unacceptable. It's an unparalleled display of independence of a central bank, as if that's not the entire point of central bank independence. And what happens in markets? The Nikkei gets crushed, drops 20%. The politicians, predictably in Japan, freak out and they demand a return to zero. And 7 months later, Hayami retreats. He completely capitulates and moves the rate back to zero. And probably not surprisingly, soon thereafter, he's out of a job, right? So that we can think about the journey starting there. Let's fast forward 18 years, December 2018. Let's talk about our own country and what I think is the greatest reversal of monetary policy in our country's history. And I say that when I measure it based on the swiftness of the reversal and the impact of the reversal. So we're December 2018, Fed meeting day. The markets are down 8% for the month, so nerves are frayed. And Powell comes out of the meeting and he says, the balance sheet runoff, so coming out of QE, it's on automatic pilot. And with those two words, the market just loses its mind. It just drops 5%. Trump says he's going to fire him. And things kind of go ballistic at that point. And I don't know if you know this, but Fed policy is that the day after a meeting, nobody in the Fed's allowed to talk publicly, but the day after, they are. And at the very first opportunity that Powell has to walk back his remarks, he saves face, doesn't do it himself, but he trots out Williams, who's the Fed president of New York, and Williams says, plans are not promises. We will reassess the data. The market knows exactly what that means, and it rockets up 15% in the next month. So like Hayami, complete capitulation. Hayami took 7 months, Powell took 2 days, right? Let's do one more. Let's fast forward to last March. The ECB, Christine Lagarde, is in charge. Let's talk about March 12th to be exact. And she is president when spreads on Italian bonds, so what they are essentially over German bonds, they're blown out. And she says her version of risk must be priced. She says her version of automatic pilot. Remember what she said? She said, and I quote, we are not here to close spreads. Like, are you sure, Christine? The markets go ballistic. During the press conference, spreads keep widening and widening out. She actually doubles down. She says it's not the function or the mission of the ECB to close spreads. She kind of thunders that. Spreads blow out even more. And do you remember what happened? Complete capitulation, except it didn't take Lagarde the 7 months it took Hayami or the 2 days it took Powell. 2 hours. It took her 2 hours. In the press conference, 2 hours after the speech, she completely walks back her comments with the quote, I am fully committed to avoid any fragmentation. All is okay. Turns out she was there to close spreads after all. And in fact, her capitulation was so complete that the ECB took the unprecedented step of revising the speech with the conference afterwards. They've never taken the remarks of a press conference and appended them to the speech. I think what I take away from these stories is that a central bank can control the supply of their money. They can't make their people value it.
It seems like Hayami, Powell, and Lagarde each felt they had no choice. What's this tell us about central bankers?
Well, I mean, I don't know. I mean, the sequence of Hayami, Powell, and Lagarde, it makes me think of the great philosopher of modernity, Mike Tyson.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, he was the best at philosophy. And his most famous phrase was, everyone has a plan till they get punched in the face. I love that one.
I think of it often.
I think of it often, too. And I've been punched plenty of times. I mean, these bankers got punched in the face really hard. And they felt pain. And they felt fear because they're human. You would have and I would have also. They got scared. They retreated. I think, though, what it really tells us about the world is that these central bankers, as well-intentioned and as well-intentioned and as good as they are, they're just up against forces far bigger than themselves. I think it tells us that the economic choice they'd like to make of short-term pain for a long-term gain, it's just out of scope for them. I think it tells us that their choice is short-term pain for economic catastrophe and certain political extinction. So they'll just keep printing. I mean, they're just going to keep printing. And that just makes corporate reserves, kind of the point of the conference, just riskier and riskier and more volatile. And what it really tells us, though, I think, is the system itself is the problem. The system is so overlevered, so dependent on free money, that just a little huff and a little puff and the whole thing gets blown down. Can I tell you just one more story?
Okay.
Okay. So let's go back to Jerome, our guy, right? Last March. He's learned the lessons of Mike Tyson's wisdom. He doesn't want to wait to get punched in the face. And, you know, the markets start to fall. Some people start to lose some money. And Powell's view through his actions, not his words, through his actions, is that no level of pre-crisis irresponsibility, no level of overborrowing, irresponsible overborrowing, no level must be allowed to have consequences. The new Fed mandate is not price stability. It's not full employment. The new Fed mandate, again, through his actions, not his words, is let's decouple risk-taking from the consequences of risk-taking. The new Fed mandate is let's finally once and for all institutionalize moral hazard. So to foam the runway for this new mandate, what does he do? Jerome goes out and he starts buying securities at a scale the world has never seen or imagined was possible. He starts buying about a day's worth of US GDP, a day's work. So I want to put that in human terms. All the work, all 350 million of us do, we wake up in the morning, we get our kids to school, we go to work, all of the work of all of us. You know, I picture Jerome kind of getting to his desk, gets the keyboard out, and just like control P click. All Americans, collective daily labor, he just prints. Now, as I said, I don't question central bankers are well-intentioned. I strongly believe they are. But humans are not supposed to have that kind of power over other humans. You know, in the same way that a stock certificate is titled to company capital, money is titled to human time, Michael. I mean, people sacrifice their time for money, which enables us to trade our time for the time sacrifices of others. That's how it's supposed to work. So a tool that can command human time, the central bank keyboard, Control-P, that keyboard steals time. And it steals time from some, particularly and most powerfully the non-asset owners, the most vulnerable. And it redistributes that time to others, most notably the existing asset owners. It adds rocket fuel to wealth inequality, and it leaves the fidelity of the signal content of prices just in tatters.
Now, I think March 2020, that was the wake-up call for me. That you're a very sophisticated macroeconomist. I was oblivious, but that was like the massive jolt of some kind of macro shock that caused me to stop and decide that maybe I needed to take an interest in all of this. And what you've described is pretty sobering. I didn't really know the history like you do, but it's clear now the challenges that central bankers face And it's pretty clear that we are over-levered as an economy. So I guess the question is, what's Bitcoin got to do with any of this? And what's Bitcoin got to do with corporations?
I mean, a lot. I mean, in my view, kind of everything. I can start with the conclusion. I'll work backwards.
Okay, I like that. Give me the answer.
Yeah, I'll give you the answer. The answer is Bitcoin is not volatile. That's the answer. And let me explain, okay? Learning Bitcoin is like, at least to me, it's like, for me, it was like learning a foreign language. You know, you live in Spain for a year or you live in France for a year. And at some point you get good enough. It takes some time, but with immersion, you think in Spanish, right? You think in French, something clicks for you. You make that switch. You're no longer thinking like, how do I say, where's the barber in Spanish and doing that English to Spanish translation in your mind. You just think the question in Spanish. I now think in Bitcoin. Okay, it's taken me 8 years of morning study. You are much faster than me. You know, I'm a slow learner, but I get there. It's taken me 8 years of morning study and a lifetime of lessons studying the markets. But I now think in Bitcoin, and it's very freeing. And through that lens of thinking in Bitcoin, Bitcoin is not volatile. Fiat is volatile. The price of college is volatile in fiat. It keeps getting cheaper in Bitcoin. The price of prime real estate, very volatile in fiat, keeps getting cheaper in Bitcoin. The price of all of my long-dated denominated liabilities like a mortgage or retirement, or we do a lot of work with insurance companies, their long-dated fiat-based liabilities, a death benefit for life insurance contracts or annuity payments, those are extraordinarily volatile in fiat, and they each keep getting cheaper in Bitcoin. And so to understand really what's going on and why this is happening, I think we need to ask ourselves two things. One, like what is money? Like what is it? And why is Bitcoin an excellent money, or even is it an excellent money? So what's money? Money is technology. It is, and it always has been technology, whether it's seashells or salt or cattle. It's always been technology. It's technology for making our wealth today available for consumption tomorrow. And virtually all of us, you know, Americans, we just take for granted that there's a sharp line of distinction between what's a money and what's not, but that's false. There's not a line of distinction. In fact, throughout history, various monies, plural, have always coexisted along a continuum of soundness, meaning good money to kind of bad money. And they've always been subject to competitive network effects, like any competition. In fact, English language and language for humans in general, that was the first network and money was the second. It also means that given enough time and at any given time, including right now, no money is absolutely the best money on all dimensions. There are always trade-offs. Some are better, some are worse, some are better at this, some are better at other things. It also means that all money is temporal. No money has ever been or ever will be forever, including Bitcoin. Bitcoin will not last forever. It may last 100 years or 250 years. I mean, maybe forever for practical terms for everybody at this conference, including you and I. But it will not last forever because money is just a good, like any other good. But what makes money as a good unique among all goods is that we value it not for its own sake, but for its prospective exchange utility, which means we hope the vessel, whatever we choose to store our money in, we hope that vessel keeps its value long enough so we can trade it in the future for stuff we actually want, right? Nobody actually wants green little pieces of paper. Nobody actually wants Bitcoin. Nobody actually wants Bitcoin either. What we want those things to do is to hopefully allow us to trade them for things in the future we actually want, a vacation, a college education, property, whatever, right? So it's not that we want the money. We don't want the money. We want what the money can do for us in the future, what we can trade it for.
So then why is Bitcoin excellent money?
Well, I think that's for everybody to make up their own mind. I'll tell you how I think about it, though. There's really two primary dimensions that I think money should be evaluated on. salability across time and salability across space. So salability across time just means, will a money keep its value through time or will it depreciate? You know, the oldest fiat money that's in existence today is the British pound. And 371 years ago, when kind of the modern British pound started, it was equal to 1 pound of silver. One British pound bought you 1 pound of silver. Today, do you know what 1 pound of silver buys you in terms of British pounds?
I'm guessing that it buys you more than one British.
More than one? A little bit. 174. So you used to buy one for one. Now a pound of silver buys you 174 British pounds. And the key here is to understand what changed and what did not change. Okay. The silver itself did not change. 371 years ago, it weighed a pound. Today it weighs a pound. 371 years ago, the silver had certain chemical properties. It's got the same chemical properties today. The silver did not change. The fiat changed. It depreciated more than 99%. So silver crushed fiat.
I hate the 99% number. I just hate that one.
Yeah, I just didn't want to take it out to that many decimals. But, you know, it's 99.763812. I don't know. It's a lot. It's basically worthless, right, relative to silver. But, you know, people talk about gold. What about silver versus gold? I mean, and the reality is gold has been far better and far more reliable. It's much better store of value than silver because it's scarcer. And it's got a much lower supply growth. Gold grows at about 2% a year. Silver grows about 20, 30% a year. So gold is a much better money than silver, but let's compare it to Bitcoin. I mean, gold still does grow. You print through mining, you print gold at about 2% a year, and Bitcoin's on an asymptotic journey to 0% inflation per year. So 2% a year, roughly times 50 years, and gold essentially depreciates completely versus Bitcoin. So Bitcoin will be worth far more than gold in the future once it clicks for people that gold is printed at a much higher rate and that compounds, you know, much higher, 1 or 2% a year, but that compounds over 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 years. But there's another property of gold that makes it weak relative to Bitcoin. And in fact, this is a property of Bitcoin that makes Bitcoin truly unique among any money in history, which is that Bitcoin is the first store of value ever in which its supply is entirely unaffected by its demand. You know, if we take the example of gold to prove this point, if gold went to, I don't know, 100,000 bucks an ounce, so up 50x overnight, you and I know what's going to happen tomorrow morning. The miners are going to get to work very early, right?
They're
You and I would drop the phone and start mining, right? We're going to start mining. We're going to look around our house for gold. We're going to melt it down. We're going to drive up the supply. We can't skyrocket the supply, but we're going to drive up the supply. We're going to drive down the price of gold. If during the course of this conversation, people really feel like bullish on Bitcoin and Bitcoin goes to a million, I'm just saying that with a smile, what's going to happen to the supply of Bitcoin? Nothing.
Nothing.
Nothing. That's incredible. That's incredible. Bitcoin is the first store of value in human history where its supply is never, can never, will never be affected by any amount of its increased demand. So the conclusion is that Bitcoin is better at being gold than gold because it's more saleable across time. Now, the other characteristic about money that's really important is saleability across space. Like, can you move the money around the world efficiently? And this is another place where gold has a really acute flaw. It's just hard to transport. I mean, forget paper gold, because then you're back in sort of fiat land and all the problems of fiat. Gold is just hard to transport. And this is where fiat, for all its flaws, and fiat's DOA, but for all its flaws, fiat really shines here. You can move it around the world. And in a sort of an internet world where network power is everything, this ability to sell across space is critical. However, I want to clear up a pretty common misperception, which is that Bitcoin is slower than fiat. The reality is the opposite. Bitcoin moves much faster across space than fiat. The key, though, is to compare apples to apples. Final settlement. And in final settlement, there's no comparison. Bitcoin increases our capacity for final, for example, international settlement by 500,000 transactions a day and completes a settlement with finality in about an hour. You know, In international settlement, you're talking 2, 3, 4, 5 days, 7 days. It can be a month, depends on the two countries. And you may not get there. And even within a country like ours, Michael, don't confuse the speed of your visa payment with its final settlement, because it's not finally settling. When you go to Starbucks and buy coffee with your Visa card, no final settlement occurs. What actually happens is your bank and Starbucks bank, they have some credit risk to each other for 2 or 3 days. Usually it's fine, but sometimes with disastrous results. And then there's final settlements. Bitcoin settles every hour, and it's a bearer instrument. It's the first ever electronic bearer instrument. So credit risk is not a concept. We said earlier that Bitcoin is better at being gold than gold. What we're saying now is Bitcoin is better at being fiat than fiat. It's more saleable across space. And because it's not debt like fiat, it has no credit risk. So the conclusion is that Bitcoin is the best money we have. Maybe it's the best money we've ever had. And that's why I've learned the language. That's why I now think in it.
Okay, I get it. It's pretty clear when you say it that way. Bitcoin's just better money, but it's not only money. And I obviously agree with you. However, I have a related question. Even if we agree that Bitcoin is better money, it comes at a cost. Bitcoin's use of energy. How do you think about that?
I mean, I think about it a lot. And I think that, you know, if people take nothing away from our conversation, I hope they take this part away about how I think about Bitcoin's use of energy. Let's start with some facts, okay? Bitcoin consumes a ton of energy. The amount of energy that Bitcoin consumes, you can think about it as the sum of all the mining equipment in the world. And there's no, you know, there's no central registry for mining equipment, so we don't really know exactly. But I think an excellent estimate is about 10 million humans worth of energy. So it's enormous. And in a warming world, how can this be good? Well, let's set some context. Like, what is the problem of energy? What are we solving? It's never been its scarcity. We can produce tons and tons of energy. It's always been our ability to channel the energy geographically. That means to move it where it's needed most. And before Bitcoin, that was always where humans lived. We needed to move the energy to where humans lived. But Bitcoin's mining energy, it's just solving a different problem. It's solving a math problem, not a transportation problem. And because of satellites and wireless internet connections, a math problem can be solved anywhere. So Bitcoin mining can be located anywhere. And, you know, the long-term implications of this, I think, are world-changing. So for example, Bitcoin can make monetizable, isolated energy sources all over the world. I mean, think about waterfalls or running rivers, or we can create dams in places that are, you know, now entirely untapped because they would be cost prohibitive to move that energy to the electric grid near where residential or commercial uses would be possible. It's just cost prohibitive. So here's the key insight. As Bitcoin's price rises, it's high enough now, but as it continues to rise, Bitcoin mining will be the most profitable use of energy in human history that does not need to be located near human settlement to operate. That's a big deal. Bitcoin is going to fundamentally change the economics of energy. And that's because with Bitcoin mining, we've got a highly profitable use of energy that's location independent. We've never had a highly profitable use of energy that was location independent. Now we do. And since fossil fuels, they're already too expensive for Bitcoin mining, I think confidently the only long-term profitable Bitcoin mining will be powered by clean energy. So imagine a future, just imagine, where Bitcoin mining firms, unsubsidized, and I think that's key, are in extraordinarily isolated locations. I don't know, let's visualize a waterfall, powerful waterfall, in a population-free part of an African country that's destitute, people living in abject poverty. And we can easily connect that waterfall to the Bitcoin network. We can build the energy infrastructure to monetize the local clean energy source for Bitcoin mining. But once we've got the infrastructure, let's extend it. Let's build roads. Let's build houses. Let's build schools. Let's build human settlement. Let's move humans there. And I think the net result will be more and more of humanity clustering around cheap, and cheap is key, clean is key too, energy sources. Historically, our challenge with energy has been to move the power to the people. Bitcoin will allow us to move the people to the power. Now, you think about the world's major population centers. I'm in New York, you're in Miami. Think about Tokyo or Paris or London. They developed where they are geographically because of natural seaports or trade routes or waterways. The placement of those cities had nothing to do with energy because they were all pre-energy, right? They were all pre-fossil fuels. With more and more of the world's population now able in the future with Bitcoin to congregate around abundant energy, and this is the key, with extraordinarily low marginal costs of production, that's the part that matters. Because cheap energy, no matter the form, equals human flourishing. That's an equation. Cheap energy equals human flourishing. And we can sign all the climate accords we want. We can add our name to anything. We can virtue signal whatever we want. Sign them all, right? They're all irrelevant. They've been irrelevant. They will be irrelevant. What's relevant is this. Because when you have people with a profit motive, and for the first time ever, we have a huge pull towards clean energy with a profit motive, that's when things change. So from my perspective, beyond the revolution in monetary policy that Bitcoin already represents, Bitcoin also represents the biggest catalyst the world has ever known for the development of abundant, clean, cheap energy. And therefore, you know, one of the biggest catalysts the world has ever known for human flourishing. It's going to take a decade or two, but that's one of the things that Bitcoin can do.
You know, I never really thought about it that way before. It's really pretty amazing. I mean, manufacturing money from clean energy sounds like a better idea than manufacturing aluminum from clean energy.
A little bit.
You got to imagine there's a lot of countries in the world that have shut in stranded energy, and they have, and we know you can't move electricity more than 500 miles. So if you could actually literally make money off of stranded energy, you can tap into your natural resources in order to move into the 21st century. I think it's fascinating. Yeah. May take a decade or two to realize the vision, but you know, given the way the economics of mining works, especially as Bitcoin's price rises, I think the energy vision makes perfect sense. It's inevitable. Okay, so big idea, Ross. Okay, going back to Bitcoin itself and your firm, StoneRidge. What is StoneRidge doing with Bitcoin? And let's break it into two questions. What are you doing as a steward of your own firm's resources? And what are you doing to help others see what you see?
Well, our own resources, you know, what are we doing? I mean, I don't know if you can read the books in the back. There's a lot of Taleb books. We like Taleb. So I'm going to rephrase your question a little bit, which is, Ross, don't tell me what you think. Show me what's in your portfolio. That's a Taleb phrase. Our reserves are now in Bitcoin. You know, it's been true since 2017. And other than what we keep, you know, for convenience, for salaries and rent and things, you know, cash we need, like fiat, our liquid reserves are in Bitcoin. So how did we get there? You know, I think great questions are underestimated. And I think we got there through a great question that our team asked, which is, what do we have to believe to be true to move to the Bitcoin standard? What do we have to believe to be true to move our reserves from fiat into Bitcoin? And our answer was that if we allow ourselves to focus only on point-to-point risk, meaning point-to-point in time from today until our long-dated fiat liabilities are due. And remember, we're a corporation, so theoretically infinitely lived. Of course, we're not actually infinitely lived, but yes, we have salaries and rent next week, but we have salaries and rent in 10 years and 20 years and 30 years too, so we can think about those liabilities. If we just think about point-to-point, the only thing we really have to believe is that over the next 10 or 20 years, that the dollar will depreciate relative to Bitcoin. And I believe that. I have no idea what the dollar is going to do tomorrow, next week, next month, next year, but I have a high degree of confidence, and I voted with my dollars, not certainty, but a high degree of confidence that the dollar will depreciate versus Bitcoin over the very long term, as it has 80% depreciated in the last 2 years, as it has 30% depreciated so far this year. So this insight allows us to ignore US dollar volatility along the way, focus on point to point, focus on end state economics. Now, like anything in life, a point to point perspective doesn't make it a risk-free perspective, but it is our perspective. And the net result is, has been, and I believe will be, enormous competitive business advantages, certainly relative to other firms in our sector and financial services. I mean, for us, everything's getting cheaper, right? So paying rent, paying salaries, M&A, recruiting, it's all cheaper. And the stock market's making new highs every day. For us, everything's on sale, right? So abstracting from Stone Ridge, though, if you take company A and company B in the same industry, one adopts the Bitcoin standard and one does not, you know, just think about the macro environment. As the money printer goes burr, if it continues to, I think it will, as credit creation just continues to explode, you know, as real rates on riskier and riskier assets continue to go negative, and we crossed the Rubicon when real rates on corporates went negative recently, you know, consider the implications for the dollar in 1 year, in 2 years, in 10 years. I don't know. Lower? A lot lower? Certainly versus Bitcoin. That's my view. Versus the yen, versus euro, like I don't know, but certainly versus Bitcoin. Remember at the very beginning, we talked about every CEO's most important job? Capital allocation. The decision of whether and how to adopt the Bitcoin standard. I believe that will be the single most important decision every CEO makes in the next 10 years. The most important decision, whether they realize it today or not. And I acknowledge well under 1% would acknowledge that's going to be the most important decision they make in the next 10 years, but it will be. And whether they actively make it or not, they make it. They make it with high consequence.
Okay. So the second part of my question is, what are you doing to help others see what you see?
Well, for a while we were trying and nothing was actually happening. I recently learned how bamboo grows. It's pretty, to me, it's pretty fascinating. It spends its first 5 years building an extensive root system underground and basically doing nothing visible. And then it explodes 90 feet in the air in 6 weeks. that's bamboo. It's not a terrible analogy to NYDIG, Stone Ridge's Bitcoin subsidiary. You know, we started in 2017. We put a great team together. We had a bunch of capital. We worked and worked and worked. You know, we laid our root system. We operated in stealth. It's true that we operated in stealth, but it's almost as if it didn't matter that we operated in stealth because no institutions really cared, and it wasn't for lack of trying. We knocked on a lot of doors. We were just too early. We were just too early. But, you know, we kept at our craft. We built our root system. We thickened and strengthened the roots. And we worked quietly, you know, out of view, which is our style. The firm, you know, has had a no press policy since its inception in 2012. But if you fast forward to today, NYDIG is a full service, vertically integrated Bitcoin only financial services firm. The first billion during that dark, challenging 5 years, it took 1,200 days to raise that first billion. First billion's always the hardest. 1,200 days. The last billion took six.
Six what?
A year ago, we had 25 institutional clients. Today, we have 280 institutional clients. We've got a pipeline in the onboarding process of 96. We can put 75 institutions through the pipe a month. That's our current capacity. We've got over $6 billion in Bitcoin now between what's in the door and what's committed from institutions. And we are vanguardizing this asset class. Best product, best price. And as we scale, we're driving prices down, down, down. Our pricing today is 70% lower than it was a year ago. And by the end of the year, Michael, I am confident we'll have over $25 billion of Bitcoin. I've just got this order book. I'm not guessing. I see what's happening.
Okay, $25 billion. Yeah, that's astonishing growth, and it matches what I suspected, but I didn't know is going on with institutions and Bitcoin. Given NYDIG's role in the Bitcoin ecosystem, you have tremendous visibility into what all sorts of institutions are doing and how they're adopting Bitcoin. So what can you tell us?
Well, I mean, the one-liner is all kinds of institutions are adopting Bitcoin. Public companies, private companies, hedge funds, private equity funds, credit funds. I mean, even investors who, if you asked me a year ago, would they come in? I'd say absolutely not. The most conservative, but also the most sophisticated, most careful investors in the world, AAA and AA life insurance companies, AA P&C insurance companies today have more than $500 million of Bitcoin exposure through NYDIG. And I know for sure, because I'm not guessing, they're just getting started. And these institutions want to do more than just own Bitcoin. That's table stakes. Within a year, America's going to be able to get a portion of their income annuities paid in Bitcoin. Americans will be able to get a portion of their salaries paid in Bitcoin. You want that paltry interest on your CD paid in Bitcoin? You'll be able to get that too. There's going to be an explosion in Bitcoin-driven financial innovation. Another interesting phenomenon we're seeing in our book is exactly zero clients have walked back their allocation. Now, that may not be true for other firms, but that's true for us. So once people get off zero, they either stand pat or they increase. Now, I don't want to overstate this. It's been a year, but that's what we're seeing so far. And another phenomenon we're seeing is among family offices. So a year ago, we had zero family offices. Today, of our $6 billion, $2 billion is from family offices, and the average account size of a high net worth individual is $7 million. So yeah, we serve retail, but the average account size is $7 million.
So the breadth of adoption across institutions and the increasing adoption within a given institution, shocking, not surprising.
Yeah.
It does seem to be, it's a one-way trade. That's the way I see
it. No question.
You're moving in that direction. So, you know, I don't think of me as a crystal ball, but what does the future of Bitcoin hold? And do you think it's too late to opt in? And I'm interested in, I know I have my opinions, but what are your drivers for the price over the next few years?
Well, I definitely don't have a crystal ball, but I think, at least from a framing perspective, I'll tell you how I think about it. I think about the first chapter of Bitcoin as kind of the genesis block until, let's call it, now. And that's been all about Bitcoin, the asset, which is really the theme of this conference. And what's driving right now accelerating institutional adoption is the view of Bitcoin being de-risked, right? And I think that's why you're just going to see a wall of money. I know it. I have an order book. A wall of money coming into the asset class. So let me put you to sort of frame this out in the mind of an institutional investor, me. Okay, I'll put you in my mind. My partners and I bought more Bitcoin in 2020, last year, than in 2013 through 2019 combined, okay? And as our fiat businesses continue to inflate and accelerate, which they are, I expect we'll buy more Bitcoin in the next 2 years and than we did in the previous eight. So what's going on? I mean, we're conservative, institutional, professional risk managers. It's what we do for a living, and it's why investors, including the most conservative investors in the world, have entrusted us with $20 billion in our alternative businesses, our non-Bitcoin businesses. And to us, conservative us, Bitcoin is de-risked. Why? Well, when I look at Bitcoin, I see it above $500 billion of market cap. I see millions of people using it every day with a clear line of sight to tens of millions of people using it every day, and then billions. I see 12 years of uninterrupted, safe operation of the network. And when I look at all that, the left tail of the zero outcome is gone. And that is the key observation. So when I talked to institutional investors a few years ago, I would get the question, you know, what's the chance of Bitcoin going to zero? And a few years ago, that was an interesting conversation. Last week, a client asked me, what's the chances of Bitcoin going to zero? I said, what's the chances of Christianity going to zero? Like, it's just not. Like, it's just left. It's left the station. And so remember, at Stoneridge, we are risk managers. We do it professionally. And what you're talking about here with Bitcoin is an extraordinarily asymmetric upside asset. We can debate whether it's good or bad, but I think we can't debate the asymmetric upside to it. It's perhaps the most asymmetric potential right tail asset in the world in history. And you chop off the left tail, we all know what happens, right, to the mean. It just explodes. It explodes. You chop off the left tail, the mean explodes. And you combine that with the macro environment, the money printing presses running at full tilt. I mean, the blue wave in the US, complete political dysfunction around the world. I mean, for us, at least at Stoneridge, fiat reserves are like a hot potato in our hand. We make them in this business. We can't get them our hands fast enough and put them into Bitcoin. We can convert them as quickly as possible. So yeah, we're risk managers at Stoneridge, but we're also capital allocators. You can't eat risk management. You can eat making money in the markets. And we believe in the power of Bitcoin, but if we didn't think we'd make money, we wouldn't invest a penny.
So you're calling chapter one of Bitcoin 2009 through today, Bitcoin the asset. And I guess that really is the process of going from zero to one. Bitcoin didn't exist. Now it does. What's chapter two?
Well, I think chapter two is going to be incredibly exciting. And chapter two builds on Bitcoin the asset, and it adds Bitcoin the network. In chapter two, Bitcoin the network, it solely leverages Bitcoin's proprietariness as an open source monetary network. In chapter one, we reached millions. In chapter two, we're going to reach billions, and we're going to do it quickly. And chapter two starts right now. So I'll give you a flavor of chapter two. Say I want to send $1,000, I'm sitting in New York right now, to a friend in Milan, Italy. Strike, Jack Mahler's firm, working with NYDIG, takes my dollars and delivers them to my Milan friend in euros instantly and for free. What? Like, how did this happen? So let's go slow. First, Strike takes my dollars from my bank account, my $1,000, and they debit it. That's a millisecond. Second, Strike works with NYDIG and we do a trade. We convert the $1,000 into Bitcoin. It's another millisecond or two. Third, Strike works with Lightning Labs and it zips the Bitcoin across the Atlantic Ocean to Milan. We're still in single digit milliseconds, basically instantly. Over there, there's another FX trade. NYDIG converts that Bitcoin into euros. We're still in milliseconds. And finally, Strike credits my friend's bank account with final settlement in euros. Done. So what just happened? What just happened is $1,000 were moved from me in New York to my friend in Milan and converted into euros instantly and for free. How? Because for the first time in history, we have an electronic bearer asset. Never had an electronic bearer asset. It's called Bitcoin. And an open source monetary network, which we've never had before. It's also called Bitcoin. That together can achieve cash finality anywhere in the world, anytime, 24/7, 365, with liquidity in any currency pair you care about. And notice something critical in the transaction I described, critical. The volatility of Bitcoin, the asset, was nowhere to be found, right? Why? Because we didn't use it. We didn't use Bitcoin for its properties as an asset. We used Bitcoin for its properties as an open source monetary network. Now, I gave you an example of two friends moving $1,000 from New York to Milan. That's cute. It's adorable. Imagine the entire global import-export industry with instant and free international settlement, right? Imagine the entire global remittance market with international and free global settlement. Imagine the entire global credit card industry with no merchant fees, right? I mean, use the open source networks of Bitcoin and the open source networks of Lightning, and Bitcoin, the network, will change the way we all interact and connect. This part, chapter two of Bitcoin, this part has nothing to do with monetary policy. This point has nothing to do with central bankers, with dollar depreciation, zero. However, there will be this virtuous, beautiful feedback loop between Bitcoin, the asset, and Bitcoin, the network, and Bitcoin, the asset, and Bitcoin, the network. And working together, the Bitcoin, the asset specialists at NYDIG and the Bitcoin, the network specialists at Strike and Lightning, they're going to get this chapter two flywheel in motion, and it is going to hum. It's going to hum. So just stay tuned for more.
Okay, that's awe-inspiring. I'm really excited. World-changing. Bitcoin as the greatest force for good in the world kind of stuff. What do you think stops so many people from seeing it?
Well, I think that it is awesome. It is awe-inspiring. And I think we just live in such a cynical age with so many people devoid of feelings of awe. It's just kind of beaten out of us. I mean, I'm grateful for many things about Bitcoin. I think one of them is it's just wonderful that I need not be among the people who are devoid of feelings of awe. I think that relates to another question, which is why people underestimate Bitcoin so much. And what do they underestimate most about Bitcoin? And that one's easy, right? That's easy. The ferocity of the Bitcoin community for Bitcoin. That, I can tell you, that is underestimated. I don't speak for the community, I speak for myself. But I think there are two core views of the community. The first view, we'll call it the individualist view, is that money is not the root of all evil. Money is a root of all sovereignty. It's the authority to act in the world as we see fit, as long as we don't harm others. Money is a property right. And since we've traded our time for money, when money is printed, our time is stolen, and that is not okay. The second view, I would say, is the community view. Money is the greatest force for good in the world today. It's an arc. It's designed to help the most vulnerable, the most unprepared, escape the accelerating fiat flood. And it's raining outside pretty hard. So yep. Let's get as many of those living on society's fringes, not just in the US, but everywhere. Let's get them in the arc. Let's get them in the arc as soon as possible, and nothing is more important. What I would say, though, is that these two views of the Bitcoin community, they're not mutually exclusive. And in fact, every single Bitcoiner I know holds both of them in their minds. You know, one of the things that really got me going and a lot of Bitcoiners going was last March when Kashkari, who's president of the Minneapolis Fed, he said, there's an infinite amount of cash in the Federal Reserve, an infinite amount of cash in the Federal Reserve. You could almost hear the other 11 Fed presidents saying, shh, Neil, you're not supposed to say that part out loud, right? Right? The American people are really smart, right? They may not have gone to the same schools as Neil or worked at the same firms as Neil, but they're smarter than Neil. And one thing they definitely can do, they can do division. If I got $50,000 of life savings, I don't really know what that $50,000 is out of, but I have a sense, right? And now the guy in charge of the money is telling me the denominator is infinity. I don't need to know calculus or theory of limits to know that my $50,000 divided by infinity, that means my $50,000 is worthless. Why would I hold my life savings in something with infinite supply? I mean, I might as well go to the beach and exchange it for grains of sand. They're an infinite supply too. So I think what Kashkari is really telling us is that fiat should come with a warning label, like cigarettes comes with a warning label. But instead of the cigarette label saying, you know, these are bad for your health, the fiat warning label would say these are bad for your wealth, right? And the cigarette pack has this, you know, this skull and crossbones on the outside. I'd like to see the Treasury start printing the infinity sign on our cash. So if you got a $20 bill, under each the numbers in all the corners, it would just, you know, have a red warning label that says divide this number by infinity. Remember, as I said earlier, a central bank can control the supply of money. They can't make their people value it. So, you know, I think that Bitcoin is massively underestimated. I think that's understandable. I mean, I think you underestimated it. I underestimated it. Until we go deep down our own version of the rabbit hole, it's underestimated. I mean, the financial establishment underestimates. Again, I did until I didn't. You know, I give them all mulligans. They just haven't put the time into it. I mean, Jamie Dimon calls it a fraud, right? Yet it's much more real than fiat. Larry Fink calls Bitcoin an index of money laundering. I think it's more akin to an index of money printing. Warren Buffett calls Bitcoin rat poison. That one's shameful. That one is shameful because Bitcoin is giving life, not taking it. It's giving life right now to tens of thousands in El Salvador and Pakistan, Venezuela. It's giving life. It's not taking it. And soon to be millions, and with Strike and NYDIG and Lightning, soon to be billions. So fraud, money laundering, rat poison, Bitcoin, it's just intellectual laziness. I think people also underestimate just how unstoppable it is. Bitcoin is just unstoppable. I mean, it'll have fits and starts as it has, of course, that's for sure. but it is here to stay forever. And that's for a simple reason, that it's open source. It's open source. I mean, China, last time I checked, pretty powerful place. They basically banned it. Price rallied in their face. India basically banned it. A lot of people lived there last time I checked. Basically rallied in their face. Pakistan banned Bitcoin, banned mining. It all went underground. Usage exploded. Mining in Pakistan after the ban exploded. It was so profitable to mine in Pakistan that eventually the government themselves, a province, started a Bitcoin miner, and they changed the legality of it. So, you know, these are the three of the four most populated countries in the world, effectively kind of said Bitcoin's banned. We're making new highs kind of even as we speak. And I think about our own country, I really don't think a ban is in store because I don't think it's possible, but we can just go there for a second. Let's just say the US banned Bitcoin. It wouldn't stop it. It would accelerate it. Remember, we kind of tried this once in 1935. We did actually ban and confiscate gold. Remember what I said before? You actually could do that. You can't confiscate Bitcoin, you could. And in the ensuing period of time till today, the dollar's depreciated about 85% versus gold. So it didn't work. I imagine trying prohibition today, right? I mean, that's alcohol and it would be unenforceable. Can you imagine trying to ban people from holding their own money? I mean, forget it. No way. And it won't happen anyway because it's private property. And we've got pretty good rules in our country about private property. And it might even be speech because it's code. So it might even be protected by the First Amendment. But regardless, Michael, none of this matters. None of this matters. Because with regards to confiscation, if you really boil all this down, what is it? It's just a password. It's just a password to a private key. And that password can easily be stored with phrase memorization in my head. So confiscation's off the table. Remember, gold has a vault. You can take the vault. Good luck confiscating my memory.
Yeah, and given all of this, it seems like individuals and corporations are being forced to take action.
Yeah, look, I think everybody now has a choice, which is a good thing. And it's a choice they make, you make, I make, and everybody gets to make on their own. You can stay on the fiat standard that's available, in which some people get to print new units of money in unlimited size, just not you. Or you can move to the Bitcoin standard, in which no one gets to do that, including you. We finally got a monetary system governed by rules, not rulers. And given that I've made my choice, you have to make yours, and everybody at this conference has to make theirs. I will tell you, I am working tirelessly towards a future with a globally adopted, inflation-proof common currency for the world, one that billions can opt into as their peaceful weapon of choice. You know, Satoshi solved the Byzantine general's problem. Bitcoin solved the military general's problem. And when you think about trends in anything, you're a tech guy, all you got to do is follow the brains. Even more than the money, the brains know first. Where are some of the smartest people in the world shifting their careers to focus? Where are some of the best developers in the world going? They're going to Bitcoin. And I'd never underestimate the power of a mass movement of developers. And don't underestimate the ferocity of the emerging decentralized class, us Bitcoiners. I mean, just like early encounters with the printing press and antibiotics and aqueducts and the internet itself, they were incalculably underestimated. People incalculably underestimate Bitcoin, totally understandably. But you, Michael, MicroStrategy, your colleagues, I think you're doing everybody an incredible service by having this conference, by having this talk and creating a platform for these ideas to be introduced. So look, you've just heard from a guy with a background in financial services and a background in Bitcoin. I straddle both worlds. So I offered my perspective, but it's only my perspective colored by my experience. You're a fellow founder, you're a fellow entrepreneur, you're a fellow CEO. You've got your perspective, you're a tech guy. You know, what do you think about this? And what do you think I've said and what I've missed?
Well, you know, Ross, I think there's clearly a macroeconomic wind that's blowing And I don't think any corporation can afford to ignore it anymore. We've all got to act. You've acted, MicroStrategy's acted. The reason we're having this conference is to help everybody else figure out what they should do. And I want to thank you for sharing all this. This has just been mind blowing. It's just awesome. I'm just so inspired. And I didn't realize there are so many institutions that were moving into this space as aggressively as they are. What a difference a year makes. Yeah. So I guess we'll wrap our session right now. And I want to thank everybody that's been with us for this session. And we'll pick up with our next session on corporate strategy and Bitcoin in 5 minutes. But Ross, thank you for everything.
Great to chat with you, Michael. Good to see you, as always. Take care.
Likewise.
Cheers. Bye-bye.
These guys absolutely crushed it. What an amazing conversation. Listen, I understand Bitcoin well. Did you hear when Ross was talking about it took him morning time? It took him, let me go ahead and mute that. Yeah. It took him study morning time for 8 years to kind of understand Bitcoin. I feel the same. It took me many years of intense, immense study. And I feel like I understand Bitcoin more and more all the time. People just joining now are able to go ahead and really catch up to speed a lot quicker. With all the beautiful learning resources and podcasts that are available, what we do here together every day. But nevertheless, the more you understand Bitcoin, the more you're able to stay firm in that position. It's very important. It's very important. This increases my knowledge. Who wants to see what the next segment is on? Who wants to see what the next segment coming up? When's that getting started? Probably in a couple of minutes. Mic check. Hold on 1 second. There we go. Mic check, mic check. 1, 2, 1, 2. Are we all clear? Bad mic. That was absolutely incredible. The more you learn and understand Bitcoin, the stronger you'll be able to hold your position. They're coming back on in a little bit. Let's see what the next presentation is and whether or not it's something that we want to take a look at. Let's see where we are over here on the calendar currently. Are they stopping for lunch right now? I'm not really sure. The more you learn, the more you earn. I've spent a great deal of time and energy. I spent years. First I got attracted to Bitcoin. And then I spent years studying and learning about it. And then I was like, okay, now I understand it. And now I know that I don't understand it. And just each and every day, I'm trying to learn more. The more I learn and understand Bitcoin, the more firm I'm able to stand in my position, the greater the position I want to take up and the greater positioned I am. There's a reason for it. This stuff was absolutely brilliant. Those of you that felt like you understood all of this, that you weren't learning anything new, I don't really know what to tell you. I know that I'm learning all the time. I have that growth mindset. It has served me well. I see a lot of you around me completely have that. No, I will take profits. I will sell. Let me go ahead and see what's going on. I want to pull up just a little bit of charts over here. I want to see what's going on over here as I look at what's going on. Dun, 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 dun. Let me be careful what I pull up over here. Just give me 1 second. There we go. Bitcoin, $37,000. Thanks, Phil. You said 5 minutes. I'm going to give it 5 more minutes or so. Check in again. See what the next segment is. And if Michael is presenting, if Michael is speaking, I'm going to watch. If Michael's not presenting, if Michael's not having a conversation, then we're going to call it a day. This will be available for those that missed the beginning on the replay. You can watch it later on the channel for sure. You can watch it over and over again. If you get caught up in a bunch of noise, if you're more focused on what you have to say, if you're trying to troll, have fun staying poor, right? You're missing probably the most important conversation you could have listened to. Probably, let's call it this year. And there it is. Do I think we'll get a retest of this trend line? I don't think so. Is it bullish, by the way? Is it still bullish if we extend down this trend line? Also, this other one over here, because this was been recent support down over there, right? What would happen if price did not make a higher swing high over here, came back down and tested either here or tested actually further down into that trend line over there? Both those are bullish if they hold, for sure. Drop below that, that would be concerning. That would be a capitulation over here. We'd probably see a spike down, a lot of people's stops get taken out, and then some of us, many of us, will that be down here with orders, the spike up and move up to the new all-time high. I would imagine would happen within days if that were to occur. But it looks like right now that Bitcoin is looking pretty solid here, pretty stable and pretty bullish. It's not just Bitcoin. You're seeing Ethereum into price discovery running. You're seeing a bunch of altcoins running, Litecoin up 10%. The whole market is participating. It looks very, very bullish to me. Let me stop in a second. Let me see what's going on over here. So we got a short break. Next session will begin at the top of the hour. Well, I don't know. It's the top of the hour. Let me just keep following, and I'll come back up when it's good. Yeah, so that's a great question. There's a video on this channel's playlist, on the Bitcoin playlist, which gets into three different ways to trade the bull market phase. One of those, this is strategy three you're talking about, but do watch that video. Watch three ways to trade the Bitcoin bull market if you really want to understand the answer to that question. Brandon does a lot of work on Cardano. You can find Brandon's channel on my feature channels over here, that and also Trade Talk. Crypto trades and tech, he's giving his thoughts and regular updates on Cardano. The way that I do it is I look for, how to time the altcoin cycle. Whether you're exiting on Ethereum, whether you're exiting on an altcoin, it's Bitcoin is the rising tide that lifts all boats. It's Bitcoin's four-year cycle that causes the movement, that causes alt season. I think the best way to get out is shared on the Bitcoin playlist. It's about a week or two after Bitcoin peaks. So as you see me exiting Bitcoin, and everyone is going to hate me, as I exit Bitcoin as close as I can to the cycle top over here, wait to position back in during the low. Accumulation stage on Bitcoin, cycle low in the bear market, getting ready to do this again. Do you want to build generational wealth, or do you want to have fun staying poor? The halving is not priced in. Right. Okay. Everyone knows about this. How can it happen again? Very few understand and know what's going on over here. We are privy to work together, iron sharpens iron, and we are able to go ahead and raise our level, to raise our game, raise our awareness, and have a good understanding of what is happening. Just because it's clear to you doesn't mean it's clear to the rest of the world. It just became clear to Elon Musk, the world's richest man in the world, that it was inevitable. Bitcoin. Let's see if the conference is starting. Let me come back over here. Waiting. They said they'll be back in a few minutes. I'm still waiting. And they said 5 minutes. It's been about three or four. When do you exit? You exit everything. Oh, gold and silver. I'd probably be positioned in out of Bitcoin into gold at the end of this bull market phase. Probably as it's happening, I'll let you know. I prefer podcasts. You know, a lot of people recommend Saffanine's The Bitcoin Standard. I own it. I don't really think it's that interesting, personally. I already kind of understand Austrian economics. That's my background. Either which way, it's probably something maybe that you want to read. But I prefer podcasts. I like What Bitcoin Did. I like Tales from the Crypt with Marty Bent and Matt O'Dell. If you want to really get into security, start following Matt O'Dell, good resource. I like following Bitcoin Denver on Twitter. Guys that understand that Bitcoin is energy, as you just heard in that conversation below. Here we go. Let me come back to it as we go live.
We're in an inflationary monetary environment. and we can expect that to continue. I think a reasonable business planner would think out at least 4 years, but I think we can see out about 8 to 10 years, we're going to be in an inflationary environment. Ross laid out many of the reasons why. It's challenging for any central bank anywhere in the world to control the supply of money. And we're going to have expansionary fiat environment for a while. And credit is flowing freely. The interest rates are at all-time low. There's no indication that interest rates are going up. So that creates an interesting dynamic. We have two interesting trends here. First of all, Bitcoin is digital gold. Second, Bitcoin is an emerging digital monetary network. Both of those are interesting and critical to corporate strategy. Let's talk about digital gold as harder money and market dynamics. Basic principle of market dynamics is capital is going to flow from weaker assets to stronger assets until every asset is equally attractive on a risk-adjusted basis. If I have one asset that's yielding 10% return and the other is yielding 5% return and the risk premiums are exactly the same, and the risk is exactly the same, then people are going to sell the one asset to buy the other asset. And of course, the prices will adjust until the actual yields are the same. This works with any asset, although it's kind of hard to calculate the risks with equities and real estate and derivatives and bonds. On the other hand, currencies are a more pure asset. So generally weak currencies are going to have capital flow out of them into stronger currencies. Truly weak currencies may just continue to see capital outflow until the currency itself collapses. That's a dynamic that's driving this market. And the appeal of Bitcoin as digital gold is as a strong asset and capital will flow to it. The second dynamic here is that we need to take into account is the technology dynamic, which is, digital gold is smarter, faster, stronger money. It's not just harder money. It's smarter, faster, stronger. It's monetary electricity, and it's monetary electricity flowing on a network. And Ross made this point. So you can build a Bitcoin into any financial product, or you can build it into any technical product. And so that means that Bitcoin as digital gold is interesting as a hard money asset to any corporation handling money. But Bitcoin as a monetary network is interesting to any corporation that has financial products or technical products. And so I'll leave those as two high-level thoughts. Now moving on to corporate strategy. What's every CEO think? What is the elements of corporate strategy? Well, first point, I want to grow my revenues and I want to grow operating income. Income derived from the generation of revenues minus cost, operating income. Every company knows they want to drive revenues north and drive operating income north. Second idea, I would like to grow my assets and I'd like to grow my investment income. If I have $1 billion and it's generating zero, I have no investment income, I have $1 billion in assets. If I can drive that to be $10 billion in assets with a 20% yield and have $2 billion a year of investment income, better. The same idea of revenue holds for assets. So growing revenues, growing assets, and growing operating income and growing investment income, these are all objectives of a corporate strategy. And if we put on our shareholder hat, I want to create shareholder value and I want to preserve shareholder value. And the creation and the preservation of shareholder value is somehow in many ways related to how I drive revenues, assets, and incomes after we take into account the leverage on the balance sheet. So the next thought that colors our considerations here is in a macroeconomic environment where the currency is weakening, the road to serfdom is working harder, ever harder, to earn a currency growing ever weaker, and then investing the proceeds of that work into assets that are growing ever riskier. Or even worse, to surrender your capital base completely. For example, you wouldn't really think twice about if you had savings in your family, you wouldn't give them all away before you had your first child. You would think, I need to have money so I can support my children. So family would want to accumulate assets, not give them away. On the other hand, we're in a macroeconomic environment where there's continual pressure on corporations to surrender their assets, buy their stock back, which is a way of surrendering assets, or to issue dividends, which is another way of surrendering assets. So why do people buy their stock back and why do they issue dividends? Well, the view is their cash and their treasury is not beating the cost of capital. So if the cost of capital is 5% and you're getting 0% yield on your cash, you're under pressure to surrender your treasury assets. And of course, that's good for the shareholders, but it's awful for the company because the company is decapitalized. It's the same as giving away all your family's assets. It's good for whoever got the assets. It's bad for your family. What's really dysfunctional? Well, the idea that you would issue debt to pay a dividend. What if I borrow $1 billion, dividend out to the shareholders? Now the company owes $1 billion. The shareholders have the billion, and my customers and my employees just owe $1 billion. So issuing debt to pay dividends isn't really good corporate strategy. In fact, you see the last 20 years is littered with bankrupt companies that actually did LBOs. They leveraged buyouts, they issued debt, they paid huge dividends to their shareholders. And then the company itself is rendered insolvent by misfortune or a difficulty in business. Issuing debt to fund operating losses, not much better. If the company is losing $100 million a year after year, and it just borrows $1 billion and keeps losing money, that's also a road to serfdom. Funding consistent business failure with debt is just putting off the inevitable. Issuing debt to buy your stock back, not really much better. If you issue $1 billion of debt, buy $1 billion in stock back, well, the shareholders have take off with the cash. They look to invest it, but your company has $1 billion in a liability. You've created a little bit of leverage, but you've burdened yourself with liabilities. Now, why do companies do these things? Well, because debt is cheap and because they're under massive pressure from outside groups to generate a positive return on their capital. And as the cost of capital keeps going up, they can't, or at least you can't with traditional treasury strategies. If you're investing in government bonds or T-bills and the cost of capital is 7%, well, you're not beating it. When the cost of capital goes to 15%, and that's about where we are right now, probably 15% or more, there isn't any conventional treasury strategy that's going to yield more than 15% risk-free interest. You know, what happens next is there's this massive pressure to give the capital back to the shareholder because they realize that shareholder value is not going to be preserved in cash. Now, that's a way of capital preservation. If I take tens of billions of dollars and I dividend it back to shareholders, the capital is preserved because they're going to presumably invest in something that will beat the cost of capital. But it's a method of corporate destruction. The companies, which create the jobs and they create the products and the services, they're being destroyed as the capital flees into some other place. So what causes this? It's macroeconomic pressure. If the environment was only growing the money supply at 2% a year or 1% a year, there wouldn't be so much pressure. When the macroeconomic wind is blowing at a 5% monetary expansion, which is what we've been like in for the past decade, there's a lot more pressure. When the cost of capital goes to 15%, becomes extreme pressure. And now every company has to make one or two choices. You either have to decapitalize, which is kind of like self-destruct. You're going to, capital is lifeblood. You're going to self-destruct, or you have to recapitalize with an asset which is going to appreciate faster than the rate of monetary supply expansion. This is where Bitcoin comes in. Now, I think there's a useful metaphor that you can use to try to figure out what's a good corporate strategy with regard to Bitcoin. And I'll call it the parable of the Argentine rancher. Let's say you have a ranch in Argentina, and it's a profitable ranch in Argentina. And this is sometime in the distant past, 10 years ago, 20 years ago. And what if I told you macroeconomically that you can expect the Argentine peso to weaken versus the US dollar by about 25% a year? This is not such a far-fetched idea, because the peso went from 1 peso to the dollar, to 2 to the dollar, to 4 to the dollar, to 8 to the dollar, to 10, to 20 to the dollar, to 40 to the dollar, to 60 to the dollar, to 80 to the dollar, to a black market rate in excess of 100 to the dollar. So the Argentine peso has collapsed against the US dollar in that range. So let's say you're a really intelligent business person and you run that Argentine ranch. If you knew this was going to happen, if you knew the Argentine peso was going to weaken in purchasing power against a benchmark, and the benchmark we'll say is the US dollar, what's a rational corporate strategy? Okay, this, by the way, this is not that hard. First, you're going to take 100% of your Argentine pesos in your treasury, and you're going to convert them to US dollars. Because you know, if you have $100 million in pesos, when it's 100 million pesos, if you look out, eventually you're going to have 100 million pesos worth $1 million, and you're going to lose 99% of your wealth. Okay, so you convert your 100 million pesos into $100 million. First step, simple step. Next, I'm generating 10 million pesos a year from the business in cash flows. What are you going to do? You're going to convert all 10 million pesos every year into dollars immediately. As soon as you generate peso and cash flow, it becomes a dollar. And if you do that over 10 years, you're going to have 100 million pesos become the discounted amount of dollars. It won't be $100 million because the discount rate is 25%, but you'll capture 25, 30 million US dollars worth of value. If you don't, your 100 million pesos over 10 years will be worth $1 million, right? So you're capturing $24 million instead of $1 million by converting your cash flows. What would you do next? Well, if I know that I'm going to have 100 million pesos over the next decade that have a net present value of $25 million if I convert them immediately, what if I go to a bank in Argentina and I finance the cash flows? I go and I borrow 100 million pesos now against the next decade of cash flow. I convert the 100 million pesos into $100 million. And so instead of waiting to lose $70 million or $75 million worth of cash flow value, I immediately lock in the next 100 million. So I finance my future local currency cash flows because they're weakening. So what would you do next? Okay, I converted 100 million pesos of cash into $100 million and I saved a $99 million loss. Then I financed 100 million pesos into cash and I saved another $99 million loss. Okay, so I'm up $200 million. What would I do next? Well, I would go and finance all of my fixed assets on that ranch. I've got all this property. There's no debt against it. I put a mortgage against it, and maybe I put a 100 million peso mortgage against that ranch. I convert that to dollars. And when 10 years have gone by, I'll have another $100 million. So I have 300 million US. If I don't finance my ranch will be worth 100 million pesos in 10 years, and that 100 million pesos will be worth $1 million. So it's another 99% destruction. Okay, finance your cash flows, finance your fixed assets. What would I do next? You know, I might actually think in terms of issue equity in my ranch. If I could actually sell ownership, let's say my ranch was worth 100 million pesos, I might sell 100 million pesos worth of stock in the ranch, convert that into $100 million, and otherwise, in 10 years, I'll have a ranch worth 100 million pesos in stock, which will be worth $1 million. So you would basically finance anything you could finance. You would issue equity in the local currency and convert into dollars. And those are all balance sheet activities, right? I'm basically converting cash, financing cash flows, financing fixed assets, and I'm issuing equity in the currency, which is going to weaken so as to buy the currency, which is going to strengthen or hold its value. Now, that's the balance sheet side. What about the P&L side? Well, on the P&L, I would want to shift my sales to markets that pay me in US dollars. So if I can sell my existing product, my steaks, my whatever, into the US and get paid in dollars, then that's probably a good idea, because $100 million a year worth of sales is going to be worth $100 million every year for the next 10 years. If I keep 100 million pesos a year worth of sales, then they're going to collapse. So my revenues will collapse. If they're in Argentine pesos, they'll continue, they'll hold their value in dollars. So I would redirect my sales and marketing to the hard currency market. Now, I would probably, what if the United States market or these other markets required a special type of product? Maybe I have to freeze dry or I have to package my steaks to ship them long distance. I'd create a new product for that market that I could sell in US dollars. If I'm a CFO, I would want to enter into contracts that are denominated in, I want my revenues to be denominated in US dollars. I want my costs, my purchase contracts, to be denominated in local ARS, in local pesos, because that way my costs will collapse, whereas my revenues will hold their value. It will look like my revenues are exploding through the roof. It'll look like if I'm selling in dollars, converting back into pesos, it'll look like my revenues went from 1 million pesos to 2 million to 4 million to 8 million to 16 million to 40 million to 100 million to 200 million, et cetera, because I'm shifting between those two currency systems. Ultimately, what I want to do is I want to expand my business in the strong currency, i.e. the USD markets. And I might even decide over time to relocate my entire business. If you take this to the extreme, sell everything, convert to USD, and then relocate large portions of my business or my marketing operation to USD markets. So that is, in essence, a hard money strategy. That strategy is the playbook that any corporation in any country on earth that had a collapsing currency or a weakened currency would pursue rationally, even without considering the technology component we have at play here, right? If digital gold, if Bitcoin is just digital gold and it's harder money, then this is a macroeconomic idea that you want to be thinking. Now, it's more than that, right? Because Bitcoin is a monetary network. So there's a technology aspect, which provides another opportunity for CEOs, but we'll come to that in a second. So big idea, let's talk about Bitcoin, corporate strategy for Bitcoin. If you want to maximize shareholder value, you want to preserve or create shareholder wealth, then you can either work on a balance sheet strategy for Bitcoin, or you can work on a P&L strategy for Bitcoin, or you can do both. The balance sheet strategy for Bitcoin is convert your fiat cash flows, your treasury into Bitcoin, as much as you think you can. Second, convert fiat derivatives into Bitcoin. If you have investments in stocks, bonds, real estates that are denominated in the fiat currency, which you expect to weaken, right? You won't be protected over the long term, because if you have a stock which is going to generate $1 billion worth of pesos, and the peso is going down by 99%, the stock is also going to depreciate in the same way. So if you're a corporation holding a treasury in cash, you convert it to Bitcoin. If you're holding a treasury in stocks, bonds, real estate, or other cash derivatives that are valued based upon cash flows, you would also sell those, convert those into Bitcoin. You could issue debt in dollars, and then you can convert the dollar proceeds, the fiat proceeds, into Bitcoin. This works, by the way, in pesos, it works in euros, it works in any currency. You in essence issue debt in the local currency, and you convert it into the strongest monetary asset, which is Bitcoin. You could also issue equity, right? If you've decapitalized your company, if you're running with a very thin, you know, if I'm Apple Computer, instead of issuing $100 billion of debt and buying back $100 billion of stock, maybe I issue $100 billion in equity and I buy $100 billion in Bitcoin, because if Bitcoin is appreciating at 200% a year, and you're investing in a company that's growing its cash flows at 20% a year or 10% a year, it's dilutive to the shareholders, right? You want to actually invest in the thing that's appreciating the fastest. And right now you've got 10 years of history of Bitcoin appreciating at 200% a year. If you, you know, when you decide what you're going to do, you have to consider, is your forecast 100% a year, 50% a year, 20% a year? What is the appreciation rate you're going to forecast? I think that it's very reasonable to expect that a strong money asset is going to appreciate at the rate of money expansion, plus with an additional driver of technology utility and technology diffusion or adoption, with a third driver, which is just broad-based network adoption. And all of that gets you to a number which is in excess of the expansion of the M2 money supply and the cost of capital. So convert your cash, convert your cash derivatives, and then issue debt, and then issue equity. And then if you can, finance your future cash flows or convert your future cash flows directly into Bitcoin, right? These are all balance sheet strategies you can pursue depending upon what your balance sheet looks like and how financeable your company is and what kind of access to equity or debt lines you might have. Every company on earth can do that, right? Every company has some amount of treasury and assets. And if you're highly levered, right, you can issue equity to get less levered. If you have no debt, you can issue debt. And if you have debt that's invested in something, you can refinance it. So the balance sheet strategy applies to 100% of companies. What about the P&L strategy? Well, P&L strategy consists of the following ideas. Number one question, can I build an open product powered by Bitcoin? And can I build a product powered by Bitcoin? What does that mean? Let's say I have a mobile payment application like PayPal or Square. if I allow you with one click of a button to convert $10,000 into $10,000 worth of Bitcoin, I've created a mobile app and it's plugged into the Bitcoin monetary network. And of course, I'm going to give my customers one button to convert a $10,000 liability that's going to depreciate in value by 15% a year into a $10,000 asset, which is going to appreciate in value at 100 or 200% a year. That's a product powered by Bitcoin. Now, what is it? What do I mean when I say open or closed? If I allow you to buy a whole Bitcoin, and I also allow you to take custody of the Bitcoin and transfer it to a hardware wallet or to a different custodian, it is an open system, open product. And I might very well get 100 million new customers that want to buy a Bitcoin on my mobile app and move it to another custodian. Coinbase has an open product powered by Bitcoin. What about closed product, closed system? Well, what if I actually let you click the button and buy a Bitcoin, but you can't move it off of my product, off of my mobile device? That's closed or proprietary. Okay, well, on one hand, it's less appealing to people that want to be able to take custody of their product. On the other hand, it might, it would be more appealing to the shareholders of your company, because if $100 billion of Bitcoin gets purchased on your mobile app and you can't move it off of the mobile app, you become a bank with $100 billion worth of permanent capital. If you have a business model that generates a 1% fee, then you're going to get 1% of $100 billion. And you're going to get it until your customers exit that relationship. And if you have a closed or proprietary system, they would have to sell the Bitcoin and pay capital gains tax to exit. And that might be, you know, if the capital gains tax goes to 45% and you have $100 billion of capital tied up in your mobile app, then your customers will have to incur a $45 billion tax in order to exit your mobile app. So that's kind of customer lock-in. Okay, well, if you're a libertarian, you're going to hate that idea. You're probably not going to want to buy that app. If you're tax efficient, you're going to hate that idea. But, you know, maybe I make it easy. I give you low fee or no fee, or maybe I give you 2% back, or I give you a benefit, or maybe just people want to do it because I'm the only game in town. I suspect that if Apple or Google let you do this and they deployed it to a billion people, they would probably have hundreds of millions of people that might not mind being in a closed system. I mean, after all, lots of us have our photos or communications or digital rights or passwords locked up in some of these cloud-based systems from Apple and Amazon and Google. And so you can actually capture the Bitcoin asset into a closed network, or you can have it in an open network. It's a business strategy. I have opinions about what I like. Other people have opinions. But the point is, when you're sculpting your product, you decide, is it a proprietary product or an open product or a mixture of both? And there's a continuum there. You can also drive revenues on your P&L by building Bitcoin tools. You can build that. You can build software tools. You can build hardware tools. And of course, you can offer Bitcoin professional services that are critical to everyone in the space. So all of these things will drive revenues and they'll drive cash flows if you choose to enter the space. So let's rifle through some examples of companies right now. Grayscale. Grayscale offers a closed-in fund, and it's powered by Bitcoin. And it is an example of a closed product. So if $10 billion flows into the fund, then that gets converted to Bitcoin. They issue shares. The shares might be sold in the open market, but the Bitcoin, the $10 billion of capital, stays in the Grayscale product. If Bitcoin doubles and doubles and doubles again, eventually Grayscale has $100 billion worth of assets. If their business model is a 2% fee, a year. They'll eventually have $100 billion of assets with $2 billion in revenue growing at the rate of the Bitcoin monetary network forever. It's a good business. It's a great business. it's very interesting. Fidelity. Fidelity has a different business strategy. They have Fidelity Digital Assets. You can buy Bitcoin on the Fidelity Digital Asset platform. You can custody it with them. So they generate fees from custody. They generate fees from buying and selling for you. And you can take delivery of your Bitcoin. You can move it off of their custody platform into your hardware wallet. So it's more of an open product rather than a closed product. But they've got this this custody solution, which is ongoing. And to the extent they offer you good services, then they will accumulate billions and billions of dollars of assets and expand that business over time. NYDIG. NYDIG is an example of a business that's a hybrid. They've invested their balance sheet in Bitcoin. They have substantial treasury holdings in Bitcoin, and they sweep cash flows into Bitcoin. And on the other hand, they offer brokerage services and custody services and value-added products, and they offer funds. And these are all products that are powered by Bitcoin, and they all meet a different requirement. So they're actually driving revenues, driving operating income, driving assets, and driving investment income all at the same time. PayPal. PayPal has more of a closed product. They make it very, very easy to buy Bitcoin and perhaps to sell Bitcoin. It's not so easy to take delivery of the underlying Bitcoin. When 100 million people have bought Bitcoin on the PayPal platform, they will have migrated tens of billions of dollars of capital onto the PayPal platform. They're in essence a consumer bank. Using Bitcoin as a monetary asset. Square has offers you the ability to buy Bitcoin, trade Bitcoin. They're more open with regard to Bitcoin, and they will allow you over time to take custody. And so it's a slightly different strategy. Marathon is a Bitcoin miner. They actually have on their P&L a very direct idea, mine Bitcoin. But on the other hand, on their balance sheet, they bought Bitcoin. So they also are exposed on the balance sheet and the P&L. MicroStrategy. MicroStrategy has a balance sheet exposure to Bitcoin. We actually converted our treasury into Bitcoin. We sweep our cash flows into Bitcoin. And we've issued debt, which we then converted into Bitcoin, right? So we've got a leveraged balance sheet strategy for Bitcoin. Coinbase is actually trading and offering custody services and other related services in a fairly open model on top of Bitcoin. Binance has got a broad range of services, and they're moving in. Not only are they trading and custodying services, but they also offer derivatives for futures, calls, puts, et cetera, and even payment type services. They're evolving into a broad-based consumer and institutional bank for Bitcoin. Bitmain. Bitmain generates hardware. They create hardware that you can use to mine Bitcoin. It's a very special purpose tool for Bitcoin. So what are the general opportunities here for Bitcoin P&L strategies? You can get in the mining business. If you get in the mining business, you're going to want to find a clean, cheap, renewable source of energy. But anybody can do it anywhere in the world. It crosses all regulatory jurisdictions. You can be an exchange. You're going to want to have exchange capabilities. You can broker Bitcoin. You can be a custodian of Bitcoin. You can be a bank. You can be a commercial bank where you're offering, extending loans or helping to generate yield or the like against Bitcoin as collateral. You can be a fund. A lot of corporations benefit from investing in Bitcoin as a fund. funds under some circumstances can give you GAAP accounting treatment and investment income, which is more favorable on a balance sheet or a P&L than having intangible asset accounting treatment. So I as a company might want my Bitcoin to be held in a fund either because it's easier, I can execute quicker, or it's more secure, or because of my charter doesn't allow me to hold the underlying asset, or because I prefer the accounting treatment that a fund might offer me. And so this is valuable. You can be in the derivatives market for Bitcoin. Here's an interesting one. Bitcoin's going up at 200% a year. The world's full of people that are afraid to own it, even though it's going up on average 200% a year over a decade. On the other hand, they would, if JP Morgan or Morgan Stanley said, we will guarantee you 10% taxable yield every year, you would have hundreds of billions of dollars flowing into those products. If you gave someone a structured product that guaranteed 10% yield, you could keep the other 90% yield. So if you create a bank that issues a structured bond, a bond that yields 5% or 10% or 20% over 5 years or 10 years or 30 years, people would buy that and you could keep the extra 170% yield. All you have to do is post the equity as the collateral, and then you have to be a creditworthy counterparty. So you could think of this as like a Bitcoin swap. In traditional markets, people would say, I'm going to guarantee you 160 basis points, and in return, you're going to pay me the short-term interest rate. That's a swap, short-term rates versus a fixed long-term rate. Well, if you give someone a fixed 10% yield on Bitcoin, give me $1 million, I'll invest in Bitcoin, I'll give you 10% forever, but you give me everything above 10%, that would be pretty lucrative, right? So there are interesting financial businesses where you get into issuing swaps and issuing bonds. All you got to do is be a creditworthy counterparty and have some equity capital so you can stomach the near-term volatility. This is a nation business. A similar angle on that is insurance. Right now, insurance, people buy insurance, they pay premiums. Those premiums are getting invested on insurance company policies into things that yield 3% a year. Imagine if I took your insurance premiums and I invested in something yielding 30% a year. Imagine if I invested in something yielding 150% a year. You could, in theory, give someone a life insurance policy where they pay in $100,000 of premiums, and then, you know, on their death, it pays their heirs $50 million, right? Some huge amount of money. Or you could reverse it, and you could offer people life insurance policies that cost one half or one third in premium by investing a portion of those funds into Bitcoin instead of into 30-year swaps, because a 30-year swap yields 160 basis points for 30 years. It's an awful instrument, and yet people fund with it right now. So insurance is ripe to be disrupted. Credit card is another interesting P&L strategy. People pay 12 to 20% for unsecured loans from credit card companies. What happens when they actually post Bitcoin as the collateral? If I basically moved my Bitcoin to you and you gave me a 6% loan or 3% loan, I could eliminate all that unsecured debt. In fact, you could pretty much rip tens or hundreds of billions of dollars of capital away from the credit card companies, and you could move it to a consumer bank that uses Bitcoin as collateral and issues consumer loans against those. And that, you know, that takes you back to the PayPal example. PayPal talks about they're going to allow you to fund your purchases off of a Bitcoin account. But really, the future of this business is I post $50,000 of Bitcoin or $20,000 in Bitcoin, and then I borrow against it. And as Bitcoin appreciates, I never sell my Bitcoin. I never incur capital gains tax. I pay 5% interest against an asset appreciating at 50% a year forever. And so you can reform consumer debt. If you're a device company, Look, the screaming opportunity for Apple Computer is build a hardware wallet into an iPhone or build multi-signature into the Apple Watch, the iPhone, and the iCloud. There's a world where you will be able to take your Bitcoin off the network, move it, what is it, cold storage, or is it sort of the key is sitting multi-sig between the iCloud, your iPhone, and your Apple Watch in some secure relationship. They can build the secure elements into the computer, into the wearable, into the hardware device, into the phone, or into the back end of the network. I think this is an opportunity for Samsung, for Apple. If you build software like Microsoft, you can build support for Bitcoin into Windows. You can build it into Android. You can build it into iOS. You can build it into all your cloud offerings. You can build it into your backend server offerings. And anybody in the hardware business probably has a play here. If you're a semiconductor company like Qualcomm or Intel, the obvious play is to actually start to spit out SHA-256 ASICs or secure elements of the like. And it's a market that's going to explode. If you do data centers like AWS or Microsoft or Google, well, the greatest data center is that Bitcoin miner. And if you create modular Bitcoin mining data centers and you're back-end integrated into semiconductors, you could drop them in the middle of Africa, on a pad next to shut-in or stranded energy, and that could be an interesting thing. Software companies, we already talked about the operating systems, but for Facebook, for any kind of messaging company, you can build support for the Bitcoin protocols and the Lightning protocols into Twitter, into Signal, into WhatsApp, into Messenger applications, into any social network, any communication network. And that's the network opportunity. I don't really have time to discuss all of those right now, but I'll just move on to just one final set of thoughts, which is there's a macroeconomic wind blowing. It's going to impact $400 trillion of capital. That capital is sitting in fiat instruments that are being debased. That capital is going to want to convert into strong money. And so if you support an on-ramp to convert that layer of money in that regulatory jurisdiction into Bitcoin or a derivative of Bitcoin, you've got a massive business. So think about a Cartesian system. There are layers of money, there are jurisdictions. Consumer savings is a type of money. Retirement accounts is a type of money. Institutions have money. There are equity funds with money that can invest in the stock market equity. There are debt funds. They have another flavor of money. There's corporate cash, treasury reserves with another flavor of money. There's state and local governments with flavors of money, pension funds, annuities, federal governments, futures and options market. They're all flavors of money. In the U.S., there's a sort of regulatory jurisdictions. If you can solve the compliance issues, you can convert that flavor of money into a Bitcoin derivative. It'll be a different problem in Argentina. It'll be different in the EU. It'll be a different set of regulatory jurisdictions in the UK or any other country. So if you're in this business, you have to solve the regulatory compliance issues that are changing. Then you have to offer a product for that flavor of money. And don't fall into the trap of thinking that there's one size that fits all. There isn't. There's someone who can click on a button in PayPal and they can buy some Bitcoin and that's all they can do and they'll be happy. And there's a corporation that can buy a Bitcoin fund and they can buy $1 billion of it in a day, but that's all they can do and they'll be happy with that. But they can't buy the one in the UK or Malta. And there's a company in the UK that can buy it a different way. If you solve the problem of how you transform the layers of money in the jurisdictions into Bitcoin derivatives, then you're going to see trillions of dollars of capital flow, and you will either capture the capital in your bank or in your app, or you'll enable it and you'll get paid. So with that, I want to wrap up with just a big idea. If you have a weakening currency, right, the real issue is capital flight. Capital flight from the nation, capital flight from a company, capital flight from a family. If you're a corporate CEO, you need to preserve your capital. Then you need to invest your capital in something which is strong money that's going to appreciate faster than the rate that the capital and your cash flows are losing their purchasing power, right? So, you know, like, stop the bleeding, right? The idea that you should give up all your capital and decapitalize the company, leverage yourself up, is the equivalent of bleeding George Washington to death, right? The physicians thought they were going to save his life by bleeding all of the toxins out of his system. But capital is blood. It's not a bad thing. When the cost of capital goes up, then the solution is not give up all your capital. The solution is expand your balance sheet and invest the capital into strong money that's appreciating faster than the rate of money expansion. All of these corporate strategies, they all come down to the same idea, which is generate strong money, find a way to attract strong capital, attract Bitcoin or Bitcoin derivatives as revenue, find a way to generate operating income based upon those strong revenues, find a way to hold that capital on your balance sheet, and then make sure that you're converting and financing all of your other assets, which are fiat derivatives, into the strongest monetary asset you can. If you do those things, then there's no reason to think that your purchasing power won't appreciate, your revenues appreciate, your income, either operating income or investment income, will appreciate. Your shareholders obviously will react favorably to that. Shareholder value will appreciate. Your stock price should go up in the public market. And the private market, your balance sheet and your earnings will simply appreciate. And that should continue for quite a while, right? We're at the beginning of a very, very long trend here. And so with that, I have more stuff to say. I don't have time to say it, but you know, follow me on Twitter and stay tuned. And we'll share more on these topics as time goes by.
Michael, absolutely just destroying it today. Michael bringing everything. Notice who he was speaking to, how he was presenting it. Do you notice how well that flowed, how much he was able to educate people today? I'm sure everyone has already seen the content Michael puts out. When I say everyone, even those attending today, but it just really, really summarizes and affirms and makes the case for Bitcoin so intellectually pure. It's absolutely a thing of beauty. Thanks for sharing that today, everyone. Thanks for being here. Listen, have a beautiful day. And I'll talk to you later.